I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the first virtual variety showcase. We have an entire week long of presentations from people from around the world, really, to talk to you about seed work and breeding work that they are working on in their areas of the world. Very excited to have you here. You guys are watching on YouTube. If you have questions while you're watching this, please type them in. And I will ask the speakers afterward. Today, we are joined by two farmers from Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. They're gonna turn on their video in just a moment. And Tom Colton from Colton Biologique and Earl Groff from Groff's Vegetable Farm. They're in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And they are gonna share with us today the traditional method for bleaching, it's called. I would have previously called it blanching, but it's called bleaching of celery. They grow celery there, and they have this process where they bury it and make it transform into something absolutely wonderful. And it's something that's traditional and very specific to their area in Lancaster. And Tom, as has videotaped this with his wife, Alicia, and Earl is the person who is speaking. They jump right into it. So we're gonna watch the video here and then we'll join them back up after the video. It's about 13, 14 minutes long and you can ask questions, type them in. We only have half an hour for this, so we gotta make it quick. So put your questions in there and I will ask them after the video. Thank you so much and enjoy.
Couple yesterday.
Yeah.
Well, middle-aged old couple, and the lady says, "Why is this celery like this?" She says, "Yellow."
Huh.
And so I told her, I said, "This is the Lancaster County tradition
yep.
or art or whatever of bleaching it," and I said, "Then it's more tender
uh-huh.
and sweeter." And news to her, all she knows is green celery.
Really. They weren't from here?
How long no. did your parents grow celery before? And they grew here for?
2 years.
2 years?
I was 3 months old
right.
when they moved here. Just up in the hill is where I was born. And then they farmed up there 2 years. But they had no creek. They just watered out of the well. And this came up, see, I'm about this. It's been here since.
And you've been at market how long?
Well, my parents never wrote anything down.
Yeah.
And so according to something at the one sale on market, my father made mention of some years, and so apparently it was mid-50s.
Mid-50s.
Yeah. They were wholesaling some things before that.
Mm-hmm.
Like celery, spinach, turnips, and that kind of thing. But all we remember is the mid-50s when we started the market. Could have been 50. We don't know.
And they grew Pencrisp as well? Or what did they grow before summer, that?
Summer Pasco was summer the Pasco. Big thing. And then they came out with Ford Hook,
Ford
which was not as ribby,
mm-hmm.
More of a clear stem, like Pencrisp stem.
Right.
And Summer Pasco was for summer celery, to tow.
Yep.
Ford Hook was for winter celery, to put it in the trench. It held long. But then they came out with Pencrisp, which did well
mm-hmm.
in the warm weather, did well in the cold weather. So we've been raising that ever since.
And that's...
And we never raised Hauser celery.
Never?
Never. Other people raised Hauser and said it was the best, but
would they like the stringiness or non-stringiness of it, or would they say it was bulkier?
Hauser celery always tended to be a little more stringy type,
yeah.
So they came out with Pencrisp, mm-hmm. and then it was a smooth stem.
It is very smooth.
Not stringy.
Mm-hmm. Nope, not at all. You never get a caught in your teeth if it's grown right, so.
Here. These aren't even ribby, really, what you call ribby.
Really smooth.
And it's all that way. And it's,
oh my gosh.
And another thing,
if
you see these hearts, like each stem just keeps growing
yeah.
up. My father always said, whatever your trench, that's the kind of story you get when you trim it.
Yep.
And that's true. If you trench stunt stalks.
Yep, you're gonna get stunted stuff.
Yeah. It just works that way.
Got it.
And so anyway, this was planted in June, the end of June, and then we started harvesting the end of August. These tile, and we use these until now.
When do you put the tile on?
In hot weather, 1 week.
1 week.
Is it long enough?
Because they'll start to melt pretty much in hot weather, correct?
That just gets mushy. But this kind of weather, it would take 2 weeks. And usually if you have really cold weather, it takes 3 weeks.
Okay.
So you have to figure ahead about how much you need. When the celery is 2 to 3 months old, then we start putting these tile on the whole stalk, as many stems as we can get in, and then it grows in there, continues to grow, and bleaches, gets yellow, parts, and that's what you want. So when you start tiling, August, the end of August, it takes a week to bleach it. It grows that fast. And then as it gets colder, then it's 2 weeks until you get temperatures in the 40s in the daytime, the 30s in the nighttime, and then it takes 3 weeks to bleach it. Then you start trenching 4 weeks ahead of when you're tiling, so that gets ready by the time you finish tile sowing. The reason you don't have tile all winter is because it freezes quicker in the town. And so if it's gonna get down to 20 when you still have tile out, you need to cover it or you lose it. And it just, bleached celery freezes quicker than green celery. And so and the tile tends to get colder. And, October 10 is when we started trenching. And so now the first trench is ready, and so that's what you try to get it to.
Yep.
This gets all, and that's ready to go. And so that's what we do. So the first trench was October 10, the second was maybe like October 15, and then October 21st is 4 weeks away from Thanksgiving, and that's when you trench for Thanksgiving. So you always figure 4 weeks ahead of Thanksgiving is when you trench Thanksgiving. So.
Now with trenching, just so the kids at home are familiar, you're doing what with the plant?
We're cutting 3/4 of the root off.
Yep.
And then we have trench about this. We can walk down to see them. If we're gonna stand in the rain.
Let's do it here, man. This is perfect. I think this is much better than sitting down. We're not sitting down tight.
And
we
put plastic on to keep the air out, so.
So you're actually extracting the plant from the ground. I'm just saying this so they hear, like, because that part. So you're taking the plant out of the ground and then re-sitting it into the trench, cutting 3/4 of the root off. So here you can see what the trench looks like without the plastic. You mold board up on each side, correct?
Yes, and then you have a scraper that we go along the side,
yep,
and make it level, and then we put tobacco paper on.
Yep.
Like this. Brown paper.
Brown paper, yep.
It was tobacco paper, now it's brown paper.
And then brown paper, then the white plastic.
Brown paper, then straw.
Straw.
And then white plastic. Yeah. This was the first planting, and this down here is the last planting.
Right.
Doesn't have near the weeds that this
planting. The first planting had more weeds.
Yeah. Another thing about celery plowing around the trench, you want the dirt up that far.
Yeah.
If it's down too low, then the cold gets in it in the wintertime too quickly. So you just scrape the trenches down level.
Yep.
And then put your brown paper on. If you have them too low, then the paper doesn't reach, because we use 3 foot glass.
A whole nother endeavor.
One other thing, all this celery that we trench,
mm-hmm,
we eventually will throw practically all of it away.
Yeah.
And that's hard to imagine that in 4 weeks we'll trim this and throw most of it away, and all the bee will be the heart that grew out, and it can be a stalk this tall, and it'd be perfect. And you have yellow, but you have to throw all the others away. We have a cutter that goes under each row that's that shaped like this, and then it cuts 3/4 of the roots off, plus the side roots. So then it comes out like these. There's not much root on, but enough to keep growing. And then you put them in side by side, and then you just pile it up till it gets full. And then carry it to the trench and set it down like this. Somebody holds the celery and you pull the box out. And any that's in crooked, the heart grows straight up, and so it would be a crooked stalk if you don't put it in straight. That's the way vegetables do. They always grow straight up. That's where the light is. and then the celery's in there for however long you might want it. 4 weeks, 5 weeks, 6 weeks, 2 months. And then it bleaches in there very slowly. You watch your trench this late is for the beginning of next year, January, February, however long it lasts. And of course then you take it out as it bleaches, and of course it bleaches so slow in cold weather. The temperature, they say the earth temperature is 55, so you can imagine that even though it's 20 degrees outside with the wind, there's still enough heat there that keeps
it. Yep.
And when you cut the roots off and you set it in there, the celery keeps growing, the heart always keeps growing up, and so it takes the strength out of these outside stems, and then they get soft and peppy, and they're good for nothing but to be cast out and trodden under the foot of man.
There she is.
This is one out of the trench.
Okay.
Do you want to flip that other light there, the switch on this side? Yeah.
Well, that's beautiful.
So this is with the roots cut off, 3/4 of the roots cut off, and then it was set in the trench. In 3.5 weeks, it bleached like this, with the dirt piled up to the side, and the celery is packed in there.
That almost looks like two plants, Earl.
Oh, this one is.
I was going to say, that is an interesting specimen.
Not often that you grow like that.
No, that's incredible that you were able to actually feed them to the point where...
Now here's a bigger saw.
There you go.
And so all these outside,
yep.
It used the strength out of this, mm-hmm. to get these roots growing again. And so they're peppy.
Yep.
They're solid.
Yep.
Once you get into this one.
There she is.
This one is more solid, and so this one would do for filling.
Yeah.
Stewing, cooking, whatever.
Look at that.
And then the rest of these you really can let on. And that's finished off.
That's incredible.
They don't all get that nice and big. But that would be a prize doll. Now this is one that one of those towel was over.
Yep.
And so you have more of this because your stalk is squished together.
Yep.
And then it cracks, tends to crack.
Mm-hmm.
And
so you get more loss.
These are more solid out here, but they're all cracked up. And there's not much you can do about it.
Look at that center one. That is incredible.
See, so now this one's even cracked, but you can let that on.
Okay.
And people can trim that off. So this here's one.
I see it. Wow.
I was gonna give you that one.
That's what I was just gonna eat. Oh man. Well.
So this one, you got cracks. Late in the season, it is that way out of town. Early in the season, you don't have that.
But unbelievable.
When the stalks get big, and you try to get everything in you can. That's what happens. And you put boron on, and that helps. It helps to keep it from cracking as much, but it still cracks.
We do that with our pumpkins as well.
Here, that should be a little sweeter. It's out of the trench. Maybe it's not much different. This, the longer it's in the trench, the sweeter it gets. And this one has a thing here, so that you'd have to take it off.
How many times can you eat the leaf? Oh, it's beautiful. World class. This is some of the best I've seen you grow.
All right. Super cool. Really excited to have with us Tom and Earl, who you just saw in the video. And Earl, hi guys. You have to turn your volume on. Okay. Yes. Thanks. This is fantastic. We're so excited to have you guys here. Farmers representing Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. They've heard so much about fantastic vegetables grown there, particularly by you guys. Earl is a lifetime farmer from the area. You've been growing vegetables for 60 years and selling them at the market there. Is that right?
Well, it's 75 if you start when I started here.
Wow.
2 months old.
Amazing.
Yeah.
This was super cool. We've got about 15 minutes for questions, so I'm just going to jump right into it. We have some people that are asking, of course, right away, like, what's like the specialty thing that people, you know, is there anything special that people do with this? Like, is there a particular dish? You know, this is a very like symbolic, it seems like, vegetable of the area. Is there anything specific that people do with it? Or would you use it just like you would celery, but it just has a more mild, tender, flavor?
Yeah, usually the heart is the sweetest part. And in our area, you just eat celery plain. But the green celery, you can add some peanut butter. It helps. It helps a lot.
Yes.
But the yellow is just to eat plain. It has a sort of a tender, sweeter flavor.
Yes. I was thinking that. And, okay, Abba just asked if you guys could turn your camera. There you go. That's great. Thanks.
Okay.
I've eaten a few like celery salads, and I was thinking about that while it's just all this celery, maybe with some dates and other things. I can send you a recipe of one that I use a lot, and I thought, ooh, this would be really nice because I love the idea of it being less stringy. Not that I don't love peanut butter on celery, of course, who doesn't? But, there's could be so many applications because I feel like it's just such an underappreciated vegetable.
Mm-hmm. One thing I might add here in Lancaster County, it's a big thing for the Amish weddings. They just have celery sitting in quart jars all day long and you just keep nibbling at it.
That's great.
That's the main thing. At one of their wedding meals.
Yeah, the Amish wedding dinner. That's a key component of the Amish wedding dinner is fresh bleached celery.
Oh, wow.
And also in the pig stomach that people serve here, a lot of the times people will add the bleached celery. It's kind of an old timey thing, but they use the green. See?
The green is more flavorful.
Okay, more so that goes into the pig stomach.
Than the yellows. Yellows mainly for just eating so.
Okay.
It's that tender and sweet.
Yeah. I was reading, if you get in there and start looking on the internet, I found some other articles that were talking about in the area, people juicing it a lot too. Like someone buying tons from a farmer there that juiced it.
Yeah. Clean celery juice is not the best. You need to add something sweet to it.
Yeah.
Like apple juice.
Yes. Oh, that would be nice. Yes.
Yeah.
So you also, it didn't get into this in the video, but you're also growing the seed for this, right? This is like the Penn Crisp variety, and you're growing seed and doing selections?
Yeah, we do. We usually pick stalks out that are smooth in the stem. That would be the true Penn Crisp. And And then we just we take them out of the trench now. If they're perfect, have a full heart, and then plant them in a pot, and then we'll plant them in the greenhouse a little later. And they'll eventually get 3-4 feet tall and seed all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way you keep the seed and then dry it for part of a year.
It's small seed.
Very small seed. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And celery seed is really tasty in itself too, right?
It is. Yeah. You can add celery seed in a lot of things,
mm-hmm.
a lot of dishes, and a lot of other things, other ways.
How long have you been doing growing your own seed for this?
Oh, probably the last 25 years, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe longer. I'm not sure when I started. Just
track of time, I know. Someone's asking about at what temperature would it kill the plants? Like, how hardy are they?
They're more hardy when it's green. Like when we were trenching, it got down to about 20 and still. It will grow out of that. Mm-hmm. It may tend to bleach a little faster because the outside was damaged. Mm-hmm. But 26, 25 degrees does not really hurt it. It's mm-hmm. it's very hardy.
That's great. Yeah.
If it's bleached in the trench when you get down around zero for too many days in a row, the cold will get in and bleach it or freeze it some. But if you don't touch it, let it come out of itself and it'll be okay again. But once you start messing with it when it's froze, that destroys it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
I love this. And we talked just briefly before we came on live about, I kind of have this, you know, romantic fascination with these kind of blanched vegetables, you know, where we work on radicchio a lot. And there's like Treviso Tardivo that you take the whole entire plant, you dig it up and you bring it inside. And these transformations that the plants go through. And there's this one right here is cardoon, which also in Italy is done a little bit similar to this, where you're growing the cardoon, you wrap it up, it's blanching inside, getting more tender, but then they build, like they dig a trough, a trench next to the row, and then bend the plant over and cover it up with dirt, soil, and then and it makes this crazy, you know, you talked about like, you guys want straight, you know, you want a straightness, and they're like going, for this like crazy kind of, I did read something also about in Lancaster County, someone else growing it and trying to get like the curved shape so it would kind of be like a spoon. Have you seen this? Did I read this correctly?
Maybe you heard after this, I don't know.
I'm not sure. The only thing that's curved is that it was in the trench.
Crooked.
Yeah.
or else after they got it out, they threw it in a trailer and then it turned crooked because celery always grows up.
Yeah.
And so it can get crooked. But when you go to package celery, it's always nice to have straight stalks.
Yes.
Crooked just is harder to package up.
Yes. Do you, is there any way to get the seed outside of your area? Like, do you sell it to others or share it to others? Is it something that people could get if they wanted to try to grow it themselves?
There's a few Amish growers that started in their greenhouses. What do you call that? They put the stuff around this. The seeds, coated. They coat the seeds. Celery seed is a little harder to coat because it's curved.
Pelleted.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, pelleted. So not many people do that. Penn State, I would think, would still have some seed in the freezer or something. They would be the place to go. Mm-hmm. We don't raise it to wholesale to other people mainly. Just
depending how this year's run went, I planted, I don't know, what do we do? A lot. We put a lot out for seed last year, so we have them in the ground now, and this summer we should have a seed run. I'm going to do some selections and then possibly have it for sale. I was mainly just going to give it back to him because the seed came from him, so he gets first dibs, but you could contact me and I'm whatever overflow we have. I mean, we'll probably have a couple pounds.
Cool. That's great. I'm sure that people would love to try it out.
I'm not sure I remember exactly how many are in an ounce, whether it's 23,000.
23 to 30,000
seeds in an ounce. So yeah. It's very small.
Yes. It's a lot. They can get some and share it with friends.
Yeah.
Are you growing seed for anything else where you are?
Not really. We just buy our lettuce seeds and Swiss chard, kale, and all those kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We don't raise any other seed.
Yeah. That's great though. I love this. How many farmers in the area are growing the celery in this way, do you think?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe 9. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's more and more people are getting out of it because it's so much work. But there are a couple of young fellas that are trying their luck at it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, there's not a lot of celery growers.
We talked about this too, like wondering, do your customers understand how much work, you know, goes into these things?
Yeah. Some do.
Yeah. Someone asked, she said, maybe I missed it. This is a grower in Washington. Maybe I missed it, but how many days is it usually in the ground prior to starting the bleaching process?
We sow the seed in April and celery in beds, and then we pull them out, transplant them about 3 weeks later, and that's usually in July, and then July, August, September, in about 2 to 3 months, then we start tallying it. So that it would be from the time you sow the seed, it would be 3 months, 6-7 months till you'd start tallying it, till it gets full grown.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Until you harvest it all, you're looking at 3/4 to a year from the time you start till you start again. It takes a long time.
I know. So in the end, how much does it cost? Like, do you sell it by the bunch? Do you sell it by weight? And like, how do you like sell it to your customers?
We sell it by the pound.
Mm-hmm.
And then we make dollar packs, $3 packs and $5 packs.
Okay.
And the same here at home. We let some people come here at home and we pack it up in the refrigerator and they just help themselves. But we don't advertise. It's all by way of mouth through the years. You can always get rid of them. Have no problem.
And how much do you grow each year? I know Thanksgiving is the big time, and maybe you said this if I missed it. I'm sorry. How much?
Usually around 50,000 plants.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a lot of handwork.
That is a lot. How many people are working with you?
I would be my son and his family. They have 8 children and my wife, and we do it all.
Wow.
Yeah.
How old
we get to work with the grandchildren. It's a family operation. It's fun.
Yeah, that's fantastic. They're are they pretty productive for you?
Yeah.
Good.
I'd say so.
Great.
Celery crop every year is different. Some years are really good and other years just aren't as good.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things you deal with weather.
Yeah.
Weather has a lot to do with it.
Well, this has been really, really cool. I'm sorry we're out of time. These are short sessions, but this has been so awesome. I really thank you, Tom and Alicia, for filming this and getting us, to meet Earl. And we love both you guys, and we're so excited to hear about this kind of traditional Lancaster celery and just share that with us. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you very much.
Hope to see you someday on your farm. Take care.
Bye.
Bye. We will be back in a few minutes with our next speaker in 1 minute.
I'm gonna be round. My vegetables I'm gonna chow down. My vegetables I love you most of all. My favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
Hi guys, I'm back. This has been interesting to go from one to the next, and poor Klaus has just been let in, and here you are live. Hi Klaus, how are you? Your volume's off.
So now it should work. Hello.
Hi, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
Great. I'm going to introduce you really quickly, and then we're going to watch your video, and then we'll come back to talk some more, okay? This is really exciting to have Klaus Brueger here. He is a small-scale amateur plant breeder that's coming to us right now from Austria, which is extremely exciting. If you don't follow him on Instagram, you should, because your photos are absolutely beautiful, and your breeding work is very, very interesting as well. And we're so excited to have you here talking about interspecies crossing of different cucurbits. This has been something that we talked about. We talked about Tetsu Kubota, which is a squash that is a Maxima Machada cross that does very well here in Oregon and other places in the US. Tastes great. And since we've been, you know, working with that, there's been a lot of interest in doing other crosses across species. And so it's really excited to have you here talking about what you've been doing. So I'm just going to say that you are in Austria. You worked with wheat genetics for your master's degree. So you do have a genetics background. And you now focus on vegetables, especially with cucurbits, with the aim of developing locally adapted novel cultivars of high culinary quality. We love all that. You're in the perfect place in an open source approach, and that you've been supported. I love how you said this. You've been supported by farmer friends and food artisans and fellow breeders in this quest. And I think that that is one of the really fantastic things about social media, is being able to talk to one another from so far away, and to, you know, to get a glimpse of what you're doing so far from us, but it is so meaningful to us as well. And for a job, you work as a collection manager and the gene bank of a seed cellular organization there, preserving crop diversity and genetic resources. So you've put together a really lovely video for us. I appreciate it. So it's a little bit low, just to let people know, turn it up on your end, but it's really fantastic. We're going to watch it, and we're going to turn off our videos, Klaus, and mute ourselves. We'll watch it, and then we'll come back here in just a few minutes. Type in your questions, guys, if you have them, and we'll see you in a few.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for tuning in. My name is Klaus Boger. I'm an amateur plant breeder from Lower Austria in Central Europe with a special interest in cucurbits, especially winter squash. In this video here, I'm now going to talk just a little bit about the possibilities of doing crosses among different squash species, interspecific crosses, and why it may be worthwhile to do them. First, I will give a very short overview about the different species, and then I will give some examples of interspecific crosses. Also from my own breeding work, and maybe I'll give a few tips and tricks on how to succeed in your own garden or on your own field. Now, when we're talking about squashes, we're dealing with five different botanical species of genus Cucurbita, a genus native to the Americas. In random order, first we have Cucurbita maxima, the species that not only gives us the world's biggest fruits, but also winter squash of exceptional eating quality, like these buttercups or kabochas with very high starch content, very dry and even flaky texture. Second species is Cucurbita muscata, the species of butternuts, but also of important processing squashes, of wonderful Japanese winter squashes, and also quite a diversity of tropical squashes that won't work here. The third species is Cucurbita pepo. This is the squash species with the biggest economical value, mainly thanks to zucchini. But it also includes very good, very important winter squashes, like delicatas or acorn squashes, and of course, you know, pumpkins in the strictest sense. Now, these three species are by far the most important ones globally, but also where I live. The fourth species would be Cucurbita argyrosperma, a species even known to spontaneously hybridize with Muscata. It's quite a cool species with some cool seeds, but it's not really known for great winter squashes. Having said that, I'm quite far away of its center of diversity, so if you happen to know a cultivar or a land race that you really like as a winter squash, please let me know. The fifth and last species is the odd one out, Cucurbita ficifolia, the fig leaf gourd. This is the cultivated species with the least morphological diversity, but it has some quite interesting properties, like a really good storage behavior. These can keep for 2 years and more if stored properly. Generally, if you want to achieve hybrids between two distinct species, distinct but somewhat cross-compatible species, success will depend on the genotypes used and perhaps on the direction of the cross. This means which genotype you use as the mother, the female parent, and which one as the father, the pollen parent. By using Maxima as the mother and Muscata as the father, you'll have comparatively good chances of getting a reasonable amount of well-filled hybrid seeds and a good eating quality in the fruits. This is also the only combination, to my knowledge, where also first-generational hybrids are actually on the market. Most of them are only used as rootstocks. But one that has gained some popularity also as a winter squash, for example, is Tetsu Kabucho F1. This is a vigorous grower and has fruit of very high eating quality. Now, we know from the literature that Tetsu Kabucho is a hybrid between Delicious and Kurokawa number 2, cultivar I reckon to be quite similar to Black Futsu, Futsu Kurokawa. So we know the parents of Tetsu Kabucho, which is rather rare with hybrid varieties. So I thought, hey, why not try to create something similar, but maybe with a bit smaller fruits? So I took chestnut, a small fruited bushy maxima with a nice chestnut flavor, but very prone to sunburn, and Gugigu, a lovely little Muscata winter squash that doesn't have any problems with sunburn, but is quite a late variety. The hybrid, in fact, gave me fruits that were quite similar to a small Tetsu Kabucho. The plants were very vigorous and high yielding, as far as I could tell. Some fruits had a very high eating quality, while others left a lot to be desired in this respect. Now, how can that be? As is often the case in Maxima Muscata hybrids, the plants were male sterile, meaning that the first flower was already a female one. This and the specific combination of genotypes resulted in a very early fruit set at a stage where the plants presumably were not able to fully support the fruit load. This problem can surely be avoided by using different genotypes, or perhaps by just eating the first fruits as summer squash. Two of the most popular winter squash types here where I live are Hokkaido or Red Kuri Maxima squashes, with their reddish-orange rind, similar to this one, and long-neck butternut-type Muscatas. This Red color you will only find in Maxima, but you won't find a Maxima with a really pronounced solid neck like a good butternut has. So I crossed Red Kuri variety Fichte F1 and Hungarian butternut Sonka. Sonka has quite a nice internal color and quite a good eating quality, and I used Fichte F1 because I wanted to use a hybrid variety in order to increase my chances of getting a good number of viable seeds. The idea behind this is that by increasing the diversity of the gametes that are involved in your pollinations, you also increase your odds of getting combinations that actually yield to viable seeds. It also gave me quite a diversity of progeny. Now these yellow ones, they might look like they are immature, but they are fully ripe. You can see it has this one here has orange flesh with greenish, very big seed cavity. This is not really a keeper. Maybe this one looks a bit more interesting. Anyhow, I did some back crosses to Sonka, and I also did some pollinations with the Tromboncino type to really get a bit more long neck genetics into the population. We'll see how that will work out. Now, one additional thing about Maxima Muscata hybrids that might be of interest to you is that they are less susceptible to squash vine borers and squash bugs. So if you have any of these pests lurking around, we fortunately don't have them in Europe yet. I'm more interested in tolerance against viral agents. You see these green stains and speckles here. This is probably virus-induced color breaking, as they call it, but I don't want to talk about viruses now. A species combination that's not often successful is that between Muscata and Pepo. I merely did this as a side project of my Pepo winter squash breeding. I had this hybrid between Tonda Padana, or Jack Belittle and Tonda Padana. These are two cultivars from different subspecies of Cucurbita pepper, so lots of gametic variability here. I used this to pollinate a Cugigo Muscata. This got me a few half-filled seeds, and I was able to establish 9 plants from it. The hybrid fruits I got often resembled pure Muscata, but some definitely showed characteristics of both parental species. The inner quality, or the inside, is now where it gets really interesting. The flesh was clearly starchier than what you're used to from your typical Muscata, and they had a kind of a waxy texture when baked. Interestingly, I also had one hybrid plant from a cross between Cugigo and pure Tonda Padana. This leads me to think that Cugigo is a remarkably good female parent for crosses with Pepo. I backcrossed the Muscata Pepo hybrids to Pepo, and about a bit more than 120 pollinations in 2019 got me 10 hand-pollinated fruits. One thing that I want to pay more attention to in the future is pollinating at the right time of the day. The different species may have a bit different optimum time windows, and there's some really specialized Japanese literature from the 50s and 60s about optimum pollination times for interspecific squash crosses, but I haven't looked too much into this yet. I just try to do the pollinations early in the morning and have finished them at maybe 7 a.m. This also fits my work schedule. Along with the pollinations, I like to remove any female flowers or developing fruits that have not been hand-pollinated and are competing for resources with the hand-pollinated ones. I think this is especially important when you're doing interspecific crosses, where you expect a lot of seed failure and where open-pollinated fruits just might be favored by your plants. It has been shown, for example, that zucchini plants selectively abort fruits on the basis of seed number. Interspecific hybrids may do a lot of unexpected things, for good or ill. With squashes, it's important not to consume anything bitter, as it will be poisonous. I was a bit afraid that my Muscata Pepo hybrids might be bitters, and something similar has been described for hybrids between non-bitter Argyrosperma and non-bitter Pepo. But luckily, my Muscata Pepo hybrid fruits were not bitter at any stage. Most of the seeds from these fruits, the Becross, the BC1 seeds, were only rudimentary, very badly filled with very small embryos. I was only able to grow 4 BC1 plants in 2020, and they were very late to set fruit, very late to produce female flowers. I'm not sure if I can get any seeds for an advanced generation. To conclude, it can be very easy and quick to get interesting first-generational interspecific hybrids like Tetsugabuto is one. It can be a bit more challenging to get true breeding, open-pollinated varieties with characteristics from 2 or more parental species. But it can be done, as is nicely illustrated by a paper by Zhang Yu and Medina, for example. And one quite popular variety on the market that you're probably familiar with also seems to have got more than just a single gene introgressed from a different species. High-quality miniature butternut honeynut has got a buttercup in its pedigree. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this brief video about interspecific squash crosses in an amateur plant breeding context. If you have any questions, I will try to answer them. If you have any comments, they are also very appreciated. We will have some time now to discuss them. See you in a minute. Bye.
Thank you, Klaus. That was amazing. Very much appreciate the references that you've cited. And as people know, I believe that this is being recorded and it will be available later on. So you can go back there and take a look at that, because there are a few squash breeders, amateur as well as professional, that are on right now that are watching and that are really interested in that. Really nice presentation, Klaus. Oh, the volume. I can't hear you. There you go. Okay. So I wanted to say that Alex Stone is on. She's from Oregon State University, and she is doing some amateur plant breeding as well with squash, and she's worked on squash quite a bit. She's actually the person at OSU that really kind of discovered Tetsukuboto in our area as something that grows really well and tastes great. And she wanted to just say another thing that she said, another good thing about the kabocha cross with Machada was that kabochas have few fruit per plant. In her experience, that she tagged blossoms, they abort most of their fruit, and that Machadas have many. So I just wanted to share that. And I wanted to ask you, like, you're doing this, you say you're amateur, but it seems like you're pretty pro, but what are you doing with are you going to release these, and will they be available for people to buy, you know, when you get to that point?
Yeah, when I get to that point, I still don't really feel comfortable to release most of my material. Haven't really gotten to a point. I haven't really developed a stable variety or a population that I feel comfortable sharing, yes, but not really to sell it. And I'm doing this on a very small scale. Mm-hmm. And of course, in early breeding generations, also then seed numbers of the lines is quite low.
Where are most of your, like, what generation, what's your furthest along project? What generation are you on?
Well, when I only count the ones that I really, where I think that they are going in the right direction, then it's F4. Mm-hmm. So,
right.
So maybe in 2 or 3 years, this is something that I can really make available more broadly.
Yeah. I was particularly interested in like what you do for selections for tasting. We've tried to do, you know, tastings in a lot of different ways. I discovered this nice website that you were on where I got the photo of you. And I put on Instagram where you were doing this very interesting looking carrot tasting, which I think was more about environment than different than really different varieties. But I was wondering how you do that. Like when you do get to the point where you do tastings, how do you prepare them? And do you use it just you, or do you have others like the come and taste with you? What's your process if you have one yet?
Yeah, also with my work, we had some squash tastings where we just, we cut it up and I put the cubes into a muffin, you know, how do you say it?
The muffin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really great. So you don't get mixed up, and then you just steam it in the oven. We did this also with Peter Lasnik, who is on later with his radish breeding.
Mm-hmm.
So I did these tastings with him,
and
with his squashes, and I also try to do this with my own lines. Maybe get a few friends, and then. Just do a tasting. And yeah, the carrot thing, this was not really my my event. These were some really cool people who tried to, Koch Campus, who tried to define the terroir of the carrot, so the same variety, same seeding date, but different soils.
Mm-hmm.
There was a really good chef there, Johan Reisinger, who prepared various dishes and various preparations. It was really an interesting.
Yeah, I mean, between that website, your Instagram, and Peter's, I'm thinking everything in Austria is very beautiful. Very nice. I have a couple of questions coming in, so I'm just going to look at these and take a look. I'm glad to know that you know Peter. He's talking about next week up, we have someone from North Carolina. And then following that, we have another Austrian who's close to by to you.
Yeah.
Great. So Alex is saying that she abandoned her breeding work and now she's going to get back to it because of you. You've inspired people.
Yeah,
are you breeding other vegetables and like with your experience in breeding for people that are, you know, maybe farmers or have less experience in like a professional plant breeder, would you suggest squash being a good place to start? Is that a good for an amateur?
I do think so. I mean, you need a little bit of space.
Mm-hmm.
But the flowers are really big, so they're easy to handle. And you don't have to emasculate and everything. And it is an outbreeder, of course, but it's not really prone to, inbreeding depression. You can also do some selfing steps. And I also want to recommend the book by Carol Deppi, Breed Your Own Vegetable Varieties. This has got me into it. I started it before I did my master's and everything. Before I went to university, really, this was the book that got me into it, and everyone can do this.
Really. Great, cool. So Alex is also saying she produced a lot of diversity in her Tetsu offspring. She struggled to develop clear breeding goals. Do you have any tips on how to guide your selections and subsequent crosses?
Huh. Well, I think it's quite difficult with interspecific crosses. Maybe if you're only up for an F1 hybrid, but if you really want to stabilize things, I think interspecific hybrids or the next generations, they do often quite unpredictable things, not really, really Mendelian what's going on. To be honest, with the interspecific hybrids, maybe a few traits that I'm looking at, but I really just observe and maybe look what might be interesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There's someone on here from Pan American Seed Company who's asking about storage qualities and if you've noticed any improved storage qualities. This is the reason that we really initially got very excited about Tetsu Kubota, is because it really, it stores so well. And we are always looking for things that we can be eating in the wintertime later on. And it was just this really fantastic thing that it also performed well and taste great too. But do you find that they store better?
I don't think I have really a good enough sample size to really be able to tell, and I haven't really kept a whole lot of fruits. What I noticed is that in the Pepo Machado hybrids, they were really more starchy. I think they had really more dry matter content. And this is, of course, then what they need to feed on. Yeah.
Okay, another specific question about breeding is, how do you decide whether to back cross with another variety versus to continue selecting from the original F1 population?
It depends on what you're looking for. And in the interspecific hybrids, I think this decision you often don't have to make, because you don't get any viable pollen in the F1 generation. So you need to do a back cross or cross with another pure species to really get forward and to restore fertility in the progeny.
What are the most popular squashes that you guys have there in Austria? You know, like we see a really big difference in the US depending on where you are. Like, I'm on the West Coast, and we have, like, for Pepos, the Delicata types are very popular. On the East Coast, it's more acorn. What are some of the squash that are kind of traditional in your areas, and what are some of the things that people do with them?
Well, traditional, it's really mostly oilseed pumpkin, actually. The winter squashes that are now typically used and that you can get everywhere in the supermarket, red curry types with different varieties. So this is not only one cultivar, of course, and they don't all taste the same. There are some that don't taste really, really good. And butternut types. Mm-hmm. And yeah, often recipes you'll find, they call for either red curry, Hokkaido, what we normally call it, or butternut. Maybe sometimes it's the same recipe and I don't get it because they are so different. But yeah, that's the two main types, I think. But you can also get Delicatas and Piena di Napoli and how's it called? The Provence, the cheese pumpkins.
Oh, like Long Island cheese and the big round ones.
It's called the Provence or something like that.
Oh, yeah. Oh yeah. Musquet de Provence. Yes. Big.
Big. Yeah.
The pumpkin, I mean, like the pumpkin or, you know, squash seed oils are really fantastic, and they vary quite a bit. There's a company on the East Coast here, Stone Boat or something, I believe, that, that has them, and they're really quite delicious. I do like those a lot. Well, I think that you have significantly inspired a lot of people here that are, you know, amateurs, and that are like, oh wow, we're gonna try to do some squash breeding now ourselves. So, you know, I love the fact so much that you're from so far away, and, you know, have come here to share with us today, but also, like, it's really cool to have a lot of farmer breeders and just, you know, folks that are just interested to inspire others to start doing this ourselves. There's quite a few people today, and then we have Organic Seed Alliance at the end of today that are going to talk about seed, saving seed, and then tomorrow we'll talk about plant breeding. So I really appreciate you inspiring others to do this themselves. And for those of you guys listening, if you don't follow him, Klaus, on Instagram, you need to. Very interesting, very beautiful stuff. Really impressive. I'm really excited to have Austria represented. Thank you so much for your time. We have to move on to the next speaker. I'm sorry. Hopefully we'll have you on here again and go longer and have a longer conversation.
I'm looking forward to the next sessions.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Klaus. Ciao.
I'm gonna be round my vegetables. I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
Hi, everybody. Back again. We just finished talking about a little bit about squash seed oil, and now we're going to talk about okra seed oil. I am really excited to have Chris Smith with us right now. He is from the Utopian Seed Project. He is based in North Carolina. He's an amateur independent plant breeder. So another person that's not a PhD plant breeder that can inspire us all to go out and start breeding on our own. He's working on an improved oilseed okra variety for culinary use. There's been really limited work that's been done for okra seed for oil, but the culinary quality is very good. He's at the beginning of this project, and he's begun growing out the available high oil content okra varieties for preliminary evaluation and crossing. Chris is a seed saver and a permaculturalist who has a background in writing. He's a fantastic writer. He wrote, and you might have heard of, The Whole Okra, which is a fantastic book. I have it on my bookshelf over here. And he won a James Beard Foundation Award in 2020 for that. He's executive director of the Utopian Seed Project, which is a crop trialing nonprofit working to celebrate food and farming. And he also, if that's not enough, has a podcast called the Okra Podcast. He is also one of the organizers of the Heirloom Collard Project that you may have heard about during Collard Week, and one of the organizers of Collard Week that we had for our winter vegetable sagra. So he has made a video for us that we will watch. Abba's gonna show that. I'm gonna turn my video off. We'll come back after the video, pop all your questions into the chat on YouTube, and we'll see you back here in a few minutes.
Hey there. My name's Chris Smith, and I'm the executive director of the Utopian Seed Project. I also am a bit of an okra fan. I've got a few things to show you just to start off. I co-host a podcast called the Okra Podcast. It's pretty fun. You should check it out. I wrote a book on okra, which won a James Beard Award last year. And I'm generally just a enthusiastic okra explorer of all kinds. And one of the big things I like to talk about is how much potential okra has. We kind of underappreciate it as a small green pod, but in reality, the leaves are edible and nutritious. The plant produces a pretty awesome fiber. This is a mess, but it's okra fiber. It can be pressed, the seeds can be pressed for an okra seed oil, and we'll come back to that because that's one of my breeding projects that I am just embarking on and I want to speak to you about. The flowers are beautiful and also can be dried for a tea, can be eaten fresh, and obviously the pods themselves have a plethora of uses, and we can explore a lot of varietal diversity within that as well. So okra already has a pretty wide genetic base, and so there's a lot of potential to adapt it in different directions. And that's already been done to some extent. Like proof of that, Joseph Lofthouse, who is known for creating land races, has commented that okra was one of the easiest crops to work with. He tells a good story of planting a whole bunch of different okra in his pretty harsh climate in Paradise, Utah, and like pretty much only like one or two plants survived that first season to go through to seed. But then within 2 or 3 years of saving and selecting and introducing just a whole bunch of different varieties, he's now able to reliably produce okra in that harsh climate. Similar story happened with Owen Bridge at Annapolis Seeds. They're actually growing okra successfully in Nova Scotia. So that's way outside of okra's like natural range, but they have been able to adapt okra just by selectively seed saving over a few generations. So anybody that wants to jump into okra and start like taking it in whichever direction they want to, they can do. It doesn't have to be for just regional adaptability. There's a guy in Oklahoma called Ron Cook who took Clemson Spineless and just continued to select seeds for heavy branching. And now he has a variety that's available through Baker Creek, I think, are selling it this year, called Heavy Hitter. And that okra can get like crazy stem, hundreds and hundreds of pods per plant, and just become this huge monstrosity of a plant with massive, massive production. So he's just been working on that for quite a few years, but it's definitely proof of its adaptability in many different directions. So what am I doing with okra? So I'm kind of like a little bit like a dog after a squirrel when it comes to okra. I will go wherever okra takes me. But a few projects that I wanted to share with you in our short time today was one that I've been doing with Seed Savers Exchange. They have this pretty cool program that, like a restoration program, and they gave me a variety 3 or 4 years ago now called Widley White. And basically they just gave me 50 seeds and said, this is a variety called Widley White. We've kind of lost some or never received the historic records of this variety, but it's rumored, or the initial letters said that it came from the early 1800s. So we know it's been in the same family for a long, long time. And it's called Widley White, but we don't really have a great description of what it is. So we've kind of assumed that it should be a white variety, but somewhere in its lineage, it had some cross-pollination, and the variety that was growing from the seed they had was a mix of different pod types, darker green pods, slightly different shapes. By the time I got it 3 years ago, there was some like wartiness coming in on the pods, and quite a lot of different plant size and all sorts of things going on. And so the idea was that I would just start selecting to restore it back to a phenotype that represented what we thought of would be Widley White, which was kind of like a shorter, stubbier, deeper ridged, pale podded okra. And it was a pretty fun project for me because back in the 1800s, a lot of the agricultural texts referenced white okra as being like the most desired okra, the supreme okra. And obviously at some point we like switched towards liking green okras more, or at least that's the one that's more available these days. But at some point in time, white okra was the one that people liked. So this old early 1800s white okra restoration project is something I've been working on. And it's just, it's proof of this adaptability, because just within 3 seasons, I'm now getting pretty uniform growth and pretty uniform pods in terms of the paleness, but they've still got quite a lot of green in them. I've never actually seen a true white okra pod, like white. But they're all like versions of pale green. So one of my objectives is to start bringing in more and more white genetics to try and get the palest pod possible is one of my personal breeding goals. And so this was kind of a good start to start seeing how strongly that white shows up. And one of the interesting things why Seed Savers Exchange gave me that project and they didn't do it themselves was because with the okra, what I've had to do is allow all the plants to grow up, assess the phenotypes of all those plants, and then eliminate the plants that weren't on type. So all the ones that were doing green pods or the warty pods or whatever it was. So I would cut out all of those plants, and then that left in my field just the plants that I wanted. But to advance my goal of getting to the palest pods, I didn't want to save pods from those existing plants, even if they were showing me really pale pods, because there's a chance that they could have already been cross-pollinated by all those off-type plants that I just eliminated. So then I had to cull all of the existing pods, all of the existing open flowers that could have potentially been cross-pollinated with the off-type genetics, to then give the plant effectively a restart. So everything that grows after that, I know that when they formed flowers and pods and then seed, it would just be pollen shared from my on-type genetics. So that's how I went about advancing my seed selection pretty rapidly with this variety. And basically Seed Savers Exchange in Decorah, Iowa just didn't have enough time to do that. But me in Asheville, North Carolina had a long enough season that I could let it grow, do an assessment, strip everything out that I didn't want, and then still have time for it to flower, fruit, and set seed. So I did a big planting of that last year, and this year I have tons of seed. In fact, I brought some of it. This all okra seed looks the same, so this isn't going to be particularly interesting to you if you've not seen if you've seen okra before. But I got a lot of seed here, and actually this is about, you can see that line here, so I don't know how many pounds that is, but it's a lot of okra seed. With the capacity to grow a lot of okra, way more than I have space to grow. So this year I'm going to do a community seed selection project with this okra. So any of you guys, anybody can really get in touch with me and ask for a packet of this seed, and I'm going to send it out to whoever asks for it. And as long as you can commit to growing that seed out and then basically sending back to me the palest pod, and I'll send instructions on how to isolate that one flower with a bag. It's very easy because okra is self-pollinating, and make that assessment and send me a photograph, then hopefully I will be able to like massively expand my grow out by getting community engagement and have all the palest pods come back to me, and we'll get towards this goal of having the palest okra pod possible way quicker with a big community project. So that's one of my aims this year. If you're interested in that, then I don't know, leave a comment or get in touch, and we can definitely talk more. The other project I wanted to share with you, just because it's kind of one of my favorites at the moment, is another variety called Puerto Rican Evergreen, or Puerto Rico Evergreen. It came out of the USDA, so whenever you pull seeds out of the USDA, they only send you 10 okra seeds, which is not a lot to begin with. And I grew this in a large variety trial. I grew about 76 different varieties of okra in 2018, and this was one of them. And it was the first to produce. It was very productive. It had a beautiful pod. I'm kind of enamored by the green pods with the red blushing on the end. And it had that, so I was kind of like instantly fell in love with it because of that. It had a beautiful red stem. It got very tall, which isn't necessarily a great agronomic trait, but as a smaller scale farmer gardener, then I quite enjoy the dramatic look of a large okra plant. And then we did taste tests. So as part of the Utopian Seed Project, we do these culinary evaluations, and I'll quickly explain them because it's kind of fun. When you do culinary evaluations, you have a fairly small subset of varieties so that you can kind of make a fairly good assessment of which ones taste good or pull out different flavor descriptors. When you have 60 different varieties of okra and you're trying to do a culinary evaluation, it's like nigh on impossible. You taste variety number one, variety number two, variety number three, and you kind of like, you got those flavors in your head. You get to variety four and you're like, what the hell did variety number one taste of? And there's just no way you're going to be able to make an objective assessment of 60 different varieties. You'll get this kind of fatigue that people talk about when they're tasting that many different varieties. So 2018 was the World Cup, the Football World Cup, and I'm British and was aware of that. And so I was inspired to take those 60 varieties and break them down into smaller groups. And, you know, usually we do like no more than groups of four. And then we just assign people just to taste four varieties and choose one of those varieties to eliminate. So we call this the elimination taste test. And so then just three advance to the next round, and we remix them all up and break them into smaller groups again. And then you just taste a different group of four and eliminate one, and it goes through. So as each round progresses, the total pool of okras are getting smaller and smaller and smaller until we get to a quarterfinal, a semifinal, and a final. And by the time you get to those rounds, like, everybody's tasting them and then discussing and getting to a conclusion of which one we think tastes best. So it's a pretty awesome, fun way to get everyone involved in assessing some flavor profiles. And I tell you all that because the Puerto Rican Evergreen was one of the top performers in that 2018. So it really had everything. It was tasty, looked good, early producer, and productive. And so from those 10 seeds, we've saved them and grown them and been able to, last year did about 150 plants and made some really good selections. Because one thing in that first year was that there was quite a bit of variability in the pod shape. So we've been selecting it for this long, beautiful, smooth, velvety pod. And so this next year, I think, will be my final selection before I'm ready to start sharing that more widely. Okay, so in my final little bit of time, I wanna shift from selection, which is kind of what I've been doing most of, to some of my breeding goals, which I'm just beginning to engage in. There's quite a lot of people talking about different okra breeding projects at the moment. One of them that I'm not doing personally, but I think is interesting, it's quite a lot of people interested in a container grown okra. So there's a guy called Skip in Texas that's been doing some evaluations on dwarf plants in containers. And then North Carolina State University has just opened a student breeding club, and one of their first objectives is to assess okra for suitability for container growing and then make some crosses to start developing an improved variety for that. So I'm kind of like just talking to those groups and not doing that necessarily myself. My primary breeding goal is back to this oil, which we looked at. I've kind of got a fascination with oils in general and feel like the South could have its own regional oil industry, and it's not going to be olives. It could be some nuts. We've got some pretty good nut production in the Southeast, but okra seems to be a natural contender because, one, that oil is delicious. It's got this real light olive oil-esque taste. Two, okra grows really well in the Southeast. And three, it's a way to grow a crop that doesn't need high externalized inputs, which is kind of important to me. You can grow it with very little need for irrigation or fertilizers and these types of things. The challenge is the okra seed has a thick hull, so it's kind of hard to press, and a relatively low oil seed content. And there's variability there, somewhere between like 9% up to 20%. And so the breeding program that I'm launching into is to start growing out the higher oil seed varieties. So the USDA has done an oil seed percentage analysis on most of their collection. So I pulled out the top 20 varieties that have about a 20% oil content, and I'm going to start growing them out and doing some crosses to try and develop high seed production, thin hull for easier pressing, and most importantly, a higher oil content. So it's kind of an exciting project. It's got quite a few challenges because you can't assess whether you've been successful with increasing oil seed content until after everything's dried down and you've run it through. So it's not like you can just eat an okra in the field and know it tastes good and then save seeds from that plant. So it's going to take a little bit of time. I've started consulting with a few universities to see if I can get some assistance with some access to machines to do some of the analysis work. But my hope, my dream, is that we will have an okra variety that is bred for oilseed production, and that sometime in the future you'll be able to walk into the supermarket and buy a bottle of okra seed oil, and that would be pretty fun. So the thing I'm going to leave you with is this year I've been lucky enough to have Southern Exposure Seed Exchange sponsor and a research intern who's coming from Arizona State University, Jordan Collins. He's very passionate about okra. He's about to go on to do his PhD, and he is going to help me do a very large okra grow out and we're going to develop a database of all the traits of all the varieties, and we've got 100 plus varieties to kind of have a baseline for future breeding projects. And through the Utopian Seed Project, that database will be open source available for anyone to look at and start being able to pull out traits for their own okra breeding project, as hopefully the rest of the world catches up and realizes how awesome okra is. Thank you so much. I look forward to answering any questions. And if you want to reach out about okra, then you can find me pretty easily.
Thank you, Chris. That was great. I just want to put in a plug for Chris's book. You guys, if you like okra, this is the okra Bible. This is it, Chris's book. Thank you. That was really fantastic.
A nerd. That was my takeaway.
Would you say a squirrel with a nut or something? Like, I love that. I'm like, yes, you are pretty obsessed with okra, but there's worse things to be obsessed with.
That's true. I'll give you that.
Well, there's so much here. This is really cool. I'm from the South and, grew a lot of okra and ate a lot of okra growing up, and never heard of okra seed oil. You did say it's like a light, like a lighter oil. It's like a olive oil sort of. I want to know like what people would do with it. Like, is it something like that you would fry with? Is it something you would eat fresh? Like, is it like, what kind of things would you do with it? And also how long does it last? Like, when does it go rancid? That type of stuff.
Yeah. Good questions. And the oil industry is kind of big and nasty. And so our expectations that we have of oil are potentially a little bit skewed, because the shelf stable oil that we get in the supermarkets is shelf stable because it's gone through a crazy industrial process to make it shelf stable. So we're not really comparing apples to apples when we have like these cold pressed, smaller scale oils that we get. Because they're just, they're unrefined oils. And that's where I think you get a lot of the flavor complexities. That said, there's one person that I know of in America pressing okra seed oil, and he's just agreed to sponsor the okra seed breeding project that we're starting this year. So that's Clay Oliver Farms. We've been in contact for a long time, and he sells okra seed oil, and he has told me that he's probably the person that's got the most experience with actually pressing and working with it. And he's kept his oil around for a good amount of time. And he just runs it through a press and doesn't do any additional, chemical solvent type stuff that is fairly common in the oil industry. Generally, I would use it as an olive oil. So I wouldn't really use it as a high heat cooking oil. Although some studies that are coming out, there's a few like academic papers on okra seed oil, and they do talk about it having, 175 Celsius smoke point. And I'm not sure what that is in Fahrenheit, but about double, right? So 350 plus. And so that's a pretty good smoke point for an oil. What I don't know is whether has that gone through a refined process, which usually makes it a higher smoke point, or is that an unrefined oil, which usually drops the smoke point? So there's a lot of open questions when it comes to this, simply because no one's really working with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I love this idea of I think about that a lot, like local fats and what kind of, oil mm-hmm. and you would use. I've had, a really good pecan oil before from the South. I think it's from Georgia. Anyway,
it might be the same guy. Clay Oliver got pretty famous for his green peanut oil and his pecan oil. Nice. He does, which he's pretty well known for. And I think because he got famous for the green peanut oil, he was able to get his okra seed oil into the hands of like Ian Bowden and Sean Brock and some of these big name chefs. And so he's gained, pretty good attention for his oils. And I think that's why.
Cool.
Yeah.
I just guess I will just say right here that I'm always shocked at how much rancid oil is out there in the supermarkets. Like, you open up oil, and not just oil, but like just, any kind of nut butter or even candy bars that have nuts in them. anyway, that's separate.
And flavorless oil as well is what gets me. It's you can buy peanut oil like pennies for a gallon type of thing, but it doesn't taste of anything, which is I think what some people want. They want a flavorless oil. But if you have fresh pressed peanut oil or fresh pressed sunflower oil, it's kind of like eating your first heirloom tomato. You're suddenly blown away by like what oil can be.
Yes.
And saddened by what it currently isn't.
Yes. Well, for okra in general, I want to ask, because I'm sure it hasn't been asked yet, but everybody's going to ask about growing okra in our region. We're in the Pacific Northwest. It's cooler. Are there varieties that you think would be appropriate to grow here? There's a lot of, you know, out there, and you seem to know a lot about it. Like, is that something, you know, we do get a lot of farmers that are interested in growing it, but don't know what variety to grow. Do you have any suggestions for that?
Yeah, the thing I'm beginning to realize, I've sent a few seeds out to Pacific Northwest. I've had a few reports back from people trying to grow it in, you know, Bay Area, San Francisco type region. And what I'm realizing is people can grow it pretty far north on the East Coast, but they still get fairly hot summers. And so okra is actually quite a short season crop. It can mature within, depending on the variety, like as few as 50 days, you can be getting flowering and fruiting. But it really does like that high heat. And it seems, I don't know a lot about growing on your side of the country. It seems like you never get those sustained high temperatures that okra really likes. So you're gonna be, it's not a case of like starting it early and making sure it's transplanted out like they do on the East Coast further north. It's gonna be a case of selecting for varieties that actually don't mind it being cool. And I think that's gonna be harder than faster maturing okra, which is the way people have gone in the Northeast. So I would start with some of those faster maturing okras just as a base point, and then basically go that kind of like Joseph Lofthouse route and just plant out a whole bunch of them, let them all intercross, and then whichever ones manage to just struggle through to seed production that first year, then one thing we do know is that there's such a wide quantity of genetics within okra that pretty quickly, I think you'll get adaptation to cooler temperatures.
Yeah. Yeah. It's our evenings. Like in the summer, we can get very warm, you know, very warm, but our evenings always drop down. So we don't have that accumulated, you know, heat unit that you find in the South.
Yeah. And that seems to be what they really need, is just though not for very long, but certainly that heat intensity is what they seem to like.
Yeah. Oh yeah, it's a heat lover, that's for sure. I think I told you I worked with cotton back in Florida. Whew.
Yeah.
I'm still trying to get over that. So Klaus actually asked, if he said he might have missed it, but have you looked into the fatty acid pattern for the oil?
Yeah, well, I haven't personally there's a handful of studies out there with a breakdown of all the fatty acids. I'm certainly not a chemist, so I don't have all the different numbers memorized, but my layperson summary is that it's proving good for human consumption because of its relative balances of saturated versus unsaturated, the palmitic acid and the allelic acids and all the different acids balance well to make it a good edible oil. So it seems promising for that. The concern I have is that some reports say that it has the cyclopropane fatty acids, which is one of the problems with cottonseed oil. It can kind of like promote infertility in animals. And so people aren't too keen on that. But it's debatable whether that even exists in okra. It's just referenced in a couple of studies. So there's definitely some chemical analysis questions to be answered, which is where I'm trying to work with some universities to help me with that side of the project.
Is there any culture or other, any like with okra seed oil? Like, is there any cultures that actually use it? that you know of, or?
I haven't found anyone that's using it. Mm-hmm. Certainly not like deep history cultures like we find with the other oils. And I think it's because you don't get a very high extraction with the current mm-hmm. seeds. Certainly mechanically, you can get a higher extraction percentage with chemicals, but just to cold press it, you don't get a whole lot of oil out of most of the varieties. Even 20% oilseed content isn't very much for mechanical extraction. So that's been kind of a challenge and why we need to up that oilseed content first. And I don't think it's been used widely across the world, or even not widely, not much at all.
How long have you been doing okra trials? Just, you know, for pod production?
I got serious about doing like larger scale trials in the research leading up to this book. So 2017, 2018, I started really scaling it up. I've only been growing okra since I've been living in America, because you can't grow it in England because mm-hmm. it's too cold. So 2013 was the first time I planted okra. So I'm a pretty newbie when it comes to okra, but I kind of took off running, as it were.
Do you have any other like love affairs with plants other than okra? I mean, I know that you're really into collards as well.
A lot of these southern crops are kind of really fascinating to me, and it may be simply because I couldn't grow them in England, but mm-hmm. I'm really enjoying exploring sweet potatoes. The southern peas are just beautiful and amazing and equally diverse. So I'm kind of just living in the South and really exploring Southern foodways and enjoying that a lot.
By peas, do you mean like cowpeas?
Yeah, cowpeas, yeah. Uh-huh. Everyone gets excited about the common beans, but there's as much diversity within the cowpeas as there are in the common beans. And yet the cowpeas are drought tolerant and mm-hmm. Love the heat and mm-hmm. don't need irrigation, don't get all the pests that you get with the common beans. They're just much more of a pleasure to grow in the South.
Yeah, great. Well, they're definitely very happy in the South. We try to grow these things here. There's a lot of interest, and so it's just about like trying to figure out the varieties, I feel like, and see mm-hmm. if we can, you know, sweet potatoes, cowpeas. I mean, a lot of traditionally African, mm-hmm. you know, crops, I feel like, yeah. It looks like our next speaker is here, so I need to jump on off and hook up with him. We went a couple minutes over because he wasn't in here yet, but I really do appreciate so much, Chris, all the work that you're doing and sharing with us. And I encourage people, if you're into okra, you got to get the okra book that he wrote. And if you have questions about okra, again, easy to find Chris. He's like involved with everything.
Thank you, Lane.
Yeah, really appreciate having you as part of our seed community.
Very happy to be here. Keep it up.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
I'm gonna be round my vegetables, I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well my bed.
Hi, Peter. We can't hear you. You're on mute still.
Now okay. It works.
How are you?
Yeah, fine.
Great.
Hi.
I'm going to introduce you and then we'll watch your video.
Moment, I have the... So, hello?
Yes, can you hear?
But, so I've lost... I had the CDM YouTube video in the background, so I hear it here. I heard the music at the moment.
Great. I'm going to introduce you for a moment, and then we'll turn off our videos and we'll watch your video, and then we'll come back on. Okay.
Yeah,
we're really excited to have you here all the way from Austria. We just spoke with your friend Klaus about an hour ago. That was really cool and super excited to have you here talking about winter radishes. This is Peter Lasnig, and he is a botanist and a biodynamic farmer. He's also he was the co-founder of the first CSA ever in Austria, and he runs a CSA right now with his partner Grundel, and it is called Sulawi Akershon. Okay, and it's a 10-acre biodynamic farm near Vienna. And they produce vegetables all year round for 100 members. Peter's an enthusiast of vegetable diversity, and his breeding activities are incorporated into his farming, which is really fantastic. And I hope that farmers that are watching will be inspired by what you're doing. Your breeding interests are really awesome. Chicoria, overwintering sprouting broccoli, winter radishes, strawberries, cardoon, skirret, and tuberous chervil. A couple of vegetables that are not popular here at all in the United States, but I really wish they were. Your breeding work with radishes, you've started about 7 years ago. You're going to talk about it in the presentation, and there's different color combinations, and it's very exciting to see. I feel like people are just really starting to really embrace winter radishes here in the U.S., so really cool to have you here. We'll turn off our videos, we'll watch your video, and then we'll come back and ask you the questions that people type in. Okay, we'll see you here in a few more minutes.
Hello, my name is Peter Lasnig. This is a party, and together we are running a small CSA farm nearby Vienna. I'll show you a little bit.
So here are some pictures from the last summer. Our farm is about 10 acres, and we make a vegetable supply for about 100 CSA members. A year-round supply. We are four persons working on the farm, and we have also some sheep, fruit trees. Yeah, and we have a big diversity of vegetables that we cultivate, and from some of them we produce our own seed, and that includes also breeding work. Our breeding work concentrates on carrots, root chervil, skirret, cardi, overwintering radicchios, as well as overwintering puntarella and some others too. So let's start now with our radishes. That is our radish field at the beginning of October, and that is the time when we start to harvest the radishes. But the harvest for the storage is a little bit later. We harvest them when stronger frost nights are going to come, so that the frost will not damage the roots. And at this time, we also make a selection, and we put interesting roots apart from those for consumption, and we select roots that have a nice shape, a nice color, and the final selection will then be in at the end of winter when we're going to plant the roots. Now at the end of January, it's a good time to start to select our roots that we will plant.
in springtime, and radish is for us an important vegetable, as it is a part of our winter supply, or it should be even more be a part of our winter supply. In our region we have traditionally the black winter radish as a storage radish, and we are experimenting since a few years making crosses between this black winter radish and other types of winter radish. And now out of this efforts, wonderful diversity of radishes has emerged.
So at this time of the year, the roots have more than 2 months of storage in an earth cellar behind them. We store them in baskets or containers. And now we take them out of the cellar and make the final selection. And here we first separate the black skinned radishes from the colored ones, and we at the same time cut them to look how the inner color is. Our original types that are integrated in this breeding are in the black winter radish, the watermelon radish, purple spring radish from the Arkenoa seed archive, that's an Austrian seed saving organization, and the fourth one is a Turkish winter radish, a red skinned Turkish winter radish. And during the last years we allowed them to flower together, and they mixed up, and now we have this wonderful diversity, and the first part are those with the black skin. And this black-skinned winter radishes originally have a very heavy taste, not so pleasant, whereas the watermelon radishes are have a very fine taste, and that's a double combination of interesting characters. On the one hand, the nice color, and on the other hand, the good taste of the winter of the watermelon radishes. So there are now two types, with red flesh and with purple flesh and black skin. So the selection of these black-skinned types is already a challenge, as the taste does not always correlate with the appearance, and there are sometimes very beautiful colored black radishes, as with a purple flesh, for instance, but they do not taste well, so we have to sort them out. But the challenge even gets bigger when we turn over to the colored radishes. So it's a huge amount of possibilities you can see here. So first we cut them to see how they look like inside. And then we find it helpful to sort them somehow related to the origin. So there are these three origins of watermelon radish, purple radish, and red Turkish winter radish. And between them, there seems to be a possible continuum of all forms and colors and tastes also. So one aspect that's important for us is the storage quality, or the ability to store them for a longer period. the watermelon radish do not store so well. They get dark spots after 1 or 2 months of storage. The same happens to some of the red radishes, or the inner quality changes and they get what we call it fluffy air is there inside, so they do not taste well longer. But there are a lot of types that do well in the storage. Interesting is that watermelon radishes that are not correct typed or that have crossed with others are better sometimes in the skin quality. So you can see it here, you can see a light red color on the surface, but no black spots. Yeah, then there are a lot of color combinations. As you've seen before, there is also the possibility that there is green color, light green color inside. The thickness of the skin or the layers below the skin changes, correlating with intensity of colors. Yeah, so that will be our task for the next days to, yeah, to taste them all and to find out really good types to work on with them. I want to give you a short update what has happened in the meantime. As it is now the 12th of February, it's really cold outside. In the meantime, we have potted our radishes at all. It's about 80 plants. And we have made selections in 9 lines. I will briefly show them to you now. The first 2 lines you have already seen before. That are the 2 black ones, one with red flesh and the other with purple flesh. And the third group is a group of radishes that strongly resemble to the watermelon radish, but it's not a pure watermelon radish. What you can see on the pale red or the color on the outer skin. The next group is a counterpart of the watermelon radish. It's purple inside and outside, not green, but also pale purple. And then there is a group of radishes with purple flesh inside and the purple skin. Then a group with purple-skinned radishes that are inside pale white or a little bit green. And the counterpart of this radish in red is the next group. It has a thick, as the one before, it has a thick outer layer, colored outer layer, and inside it's white or greenish. And then there are 2 heterogeneous groups. The one of them is red or pale red inside as well as outside. And the next one is the counterpart in purple. So that are the groups we have formed, and the black ones we will separate strictly from the others, and the other groups we do not separate so strictly when they are flowering. We group them together, but not isolated from each other. We hope that we will have a good seed harvest this year. and are looking forward what will come to expression in next autumn. So thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoyed, and are I'm looking forward for your questions in the following minutes. Thank you.
Fantastic, Peter. Really cool. I feel like winter radishes are not as appreciated here as they are. We're hoping to change that. A lot of the farmers that I work with, and some are texting me while they're watching this, are very excited to see. They like growing them a lot. They do have some challenges with cabbage root maggot. I wonder if that was a problem where you are, but they do really like growing them, and people are starting to appreciate them more. So I have some questions around that. But do you guys have this insect problem that bores into the radishes?
Yeah, that's a problem here too. So it's difficult to cultivate them too early in the year. At the end of summer, beginning of autumn, it works better. But we cover them with a net to protect them from the insects. Okay. Otherwise, it would be difficult, very difficult.
They're so beautiful. The work you're doing is so great. You know, it is this thing that I feel like we can kind of like radicchio, you know, it's so beautiful that you can get people to eat something that maybe they wouldn't particularly want to. Like for us as a, you know, American palates are different. And so a lot of times not liking the bitterness or spiciness of certain vegetables. So it helps for them to be so beautiful. And yours certainly are. I get them in my CSA. I just received some the other day, and they were like the Spanish black ones, and then also like daikons that are green, and then some like watermelon radishes. So I slice them very thin on like a mandolin and make like some sort of a dip. I made like a tomato dip and just eat them this way. But I wonder what do people do in Austria with them? Like, what are some of the dishes that you like to have them in?
It's very similar. I use them the same way too. I often eat them on bread, thin slices, and it looks very pretty, the different colors on the bread. So radishes are not so popular in Austria. These traditional radishes, they are somehow a medicine. You make a hole inside and you put sugar in, and then if you have a cough or you drink the syrup. Uh-huh. And for me, this watermelon radishes, they were really a surprise in taste. And so my love with the radishes started with the watermelon radishes when I discovered them.
Yes. Yeah, the watermelon radish, I feel like, is maybe the most popular one here because it's so striking. People really like that. At the market, cut them in half and show, you know, to show people what they are inside. They definitely become less spicy too if you soak them in cold water. I did that to keep it crisp, and then the spiciness went away, which I was a little bit sad about because I like the spiciness. What about cooking them? Do you guys do very much with cooking, roasting?
I do not do it this way. I haven't tried yet. So we have some members in our CSA that cook the radishes, but I prefer to eat them raw, salad or bread.
Do you, when you give them in their CSA, do you give people ideas for all of your, you know, for all your vegetables? Do you give them ideas of like how to prepare them and cook things?
We write a weekly newsletter, and when we have a new vegetable, we introduce it and tell how to use it.
I'm looking at these questions. Someone said, with the growing variety of colors and tastes, and as you say, they are not very appreciated, how do you showcase this wonderful vegetable to your CSA members? I guess, how do you get them excited about it?
The color is very
the color speaks on its own somehow. So we cut them on the market when we give them to our members, and we let them taste. Mm-hmm. And it's also with this newsletter we write about. And so members come to our farm, and we try to integrate the members also in this selection work, as it's happened this year too. And that's for us also a very exciting process to integrate our members in this breeding process.
Yeah, I love that idea. I think about that a lot and trying to get people, you know, I mean, it's hard during COVID times, but like when you're not, to give them these things and then have like maybe a little field day or a gathering at your farm to taste them all together and see what people have to say about them and what they like. How did you get started? I mean, you've been farming for a long time, and what made you decide to start getting involved in seed and doing your own breeding?
Yeah, so the initial interest was the interest in diversity of vegetables. Mm-hmm. I first wanted to start. During my studies, I learned a little bit about breeding or breeding in the laboratory, but I had a feeling that's not the way I want to do it. So I went into the practice and with the idea to combine this, to combine the practical work with the breeding work. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't define myself as a breeder, or perhaps I'm an amateur breeder, but I'm a farmer, and we do a lot of seed work, and we propagate our vegetables. And in this process, we select, and the diversity of of radishes was somehow a present that came to us when we propagated different radishes. It wasn't planned to come to this point at this now. Mm-hmm. It's developed somehow, and I do not have a clear picture where it will go, but it develops.
And what other things are you breeding? You're breeding cardoon and some other chicoria and the chervil. You have many things going on, projects going on, right?
Yeah, there are so many interesting vegetables, and in the CSA farm, perhaps it's more easy to combine this breeding work with the growing work, as we harvest, and the harvest process is somehow a selection process at the same mm-hmm. time. When we harvest the vegetables, we see what has come out of our own seeds, and it's so interesting. I like this process of taking out the best ones, and not to eat them, but to keep them and to make new seeds out of them for the next generations. That's really motivating.
Does all your seeds stay on your farm, or do you share with other farmers around you? Do you ever sell your seed?
We share it with other farmers if there's interest in this. And we are also member of different groups where we share our seeds. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's great. I mean, it's such an inspiration, I feel like. It's a lot more work to grow your own seed and to breed. Also, I feel like I spend a lot of time explaining to people that aren't involved in farming at all that it's like a very separate, you know, it's a whole different set of, skills and things that you're doing. And usually farmers don't have time for it. So it's always very inspirational to see someone that's doing that on their own farm, because really you will have really fantastic results because you have things that are exactly what you want, that grow very well where you are, that your customers like. I mean, it must be really cool for them too to feel like they're a part of that work too and creating new varieties.
I appreciate it very much, this kind of work, and to integrate this the seed production with the vegetable production. And it's
somehow it's far away in the head as we are used to buy seeds, but it's you can individualize your vegetables or your project or your farm. Planting your own.
How much of your own seed are you producing, would you say? Like, is it like 10%, 25%?
No, I think it's more than the half of the
vegetables. Oh, wow. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So all the important vegetables in our supply, we save our own seeds. And in this process, there's always a little bit selection too. And sometimes some crosses happen, and then the breeding process starts.
You know, I wonder, in Austria, I wonder if it's similar to the things I've seen in Italy, where I've gone to farms in Italy where most of them are not growing their own transplants. They buy plants from the nursery, so they actually aren't buying seed and growing their own seed, you know, unless it's direct seeded. Are the majority of the farms in your area growing their own starts, you know, transplants, or do they buy from a commercial nursery?
No, that's the usual way to hear that plants are bought from a nursery. Yeah.
Yes, this is unusual for us. The farmers that are watching, and it's just not the way that they grow their own starts here. So it was really different for us to see that. So it does allow you to have a lot more. If you're doing it, you have a lot more control over being able to choose your own seed varieties and produce your own seed. Because so when you're growing your own seed, do you give your seed to a commercial nursery to grow them for you, or do you grow them yourself?
We do both. Okay. So we do not have enough place to grow all our plants. So we have nearby a nursery. We collaborate, and we also give them seeds from our seed work.
Great. People are just saying that they love what you're doing. People are very excited about the radishes. I mean, I have had a lot of comments on YouTube and in text messages and messages on Instagram, like very excited about your work and the radishes. So. And your Instagram is quite beautiful. I was telling Klaus, I said, my goodness, between the two of you guys and this one other website I happened to find something on about him, I'm like, it looks like things in Austria are just beautiful. And that you all focus so much on beauty and like really appreciate that. So it really comes through in your work that like quality and beauty is a value, and that's very appreciated. Well, we have to move on to the next speaker. I'm sorry, because these are short, but we could talk about radishes forever. And I do want to be in contact with you because we have written some grant proposals. If they come through, we will be working on winter radishes, and love to collaborate with you as much as we can on that. But it's really lovely to see your work. Thank you so much for spending the time to make the video and share with us.
Thank you for the possibility to do this. Yeah.
Of course. Okay. I'm going to turn the video off, and we're going to be joined with Organic Seed Alliance, who's going to talk to us about how to save seed yourselves. Okay, thank you.
I'm going to be around my vegetables. I'm going to chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well my bed.
Okay. We've had four really fantastic speakers this morning. talking about their breeding work that they're doing at, which, and one thing that's really cool is a lot of amateur plant breeding and farmer breeders. So there seems to be a lot of interest in people, you know, learning to do this themselves. And that's why you guys are here. We're joined today with Organic Seed Alliance for an hour to talk about seed saving today. And then tomorrow, another hour, same time, same place, specifically about plant breeding. And so we have Michaela Colley, we have Jared Zeistro, and we have Lori McKenzie that are from the Organic Seed Alliance. I'm imagining you guys have heard of the Organic Seed Alliance, the world premiere seed nonprofit for advocacy and education. I'm going to tell you that just a little bit about them before we start. The mission of OSA is to advance ethical seed solutions to meet farm food and farming needs in a changing world. They teach seed saving in a variety of forms, from basic backyard skills to farm scale organic seed production. They teach farmers how to conduct organic plant breeding in their own fields, empowering them to adapt their crops to changing environments, environmental conditions, and market needs. We just saw this. Peter from Austria was just on, and he is a farmer that has a 10-acre biodynamic farm and started growing his own seed. And it's better for his farm, tastes great. His consumers are, his customers are like involved in some of the selection. So, I mean, like we just had the perfect example of that. And you guys teach people how to do that. And I posted about this yesterday, but like what the variety showcase has been in the past is what we've been doing so far this morning, where it's like plant breeders are talking about their breeding, showing it to the world. Sometimes, you know, we don't get to see that type of thing. And so it's a really cool way to see what plant breeders do and for them to get some input. But when we had registration for this and we asked people, like, what do you want to, you know, what do you want to learn about? A lot of people said they wanted to learn how to save seed. And this is people that are just backyard gardeners or haven't even started gardening to farmers. So you guys are here to help us. And I really, really appreciate that. So I'm going to hand it over to you guys. And thanks so much for being here. This is on YouTube. So people will type in their questions. I see that. I don't know if you guys are looking at that too, but I can ask you those questions. And you guys just let me know the format that you wanna be in. I'm tech support now because Ava had to go. We're in trouble if anything happens.
Yeah, great. So Lane, the three of us are going to teach together. And in order to make it digestible, we broke it down into like 10 to 12 minute segments. And then we're planning on making time for Q&A in between those. And so that in between time, if you could be reading out those questions, we'll also use that as an opportunity to change who's controlling the screen. Okay, awesome. All right, well, let's get started. I'm Michaela Colley, a program director for Organic Seed Alliance. And I'm here today with Lori McKenzie, the Northwest Research and Education Associate of OSA, and Jared Zeistro, co-director of Research and Education. I'm just going to share a little bit of basic, really starting from the very beginning. You never saved seed before. Where do you begin? Lori's going to take you into the biology a little bit deeper, and then Jared will give you a little bit of how-tos. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen because I know how to do this. And here we go. Dun, 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 slideshow from the start. Okay. As Lane said, we're here from Organic Seed Alliance. We're a national nonprofit with programs that really focus on developing robust regional seed systems because seed is very relevant in terms of the climate regionally and the relationships between seed stewards within a region. So if you're just starting to save seed, some considerations you might want to think about is picking a crop that is self-pollinated and an annual. So we're going to talk a little bit about what those words mean in a moment here, but self-pollinated means basically you don't have to worry about it crossing with other crops in your garden or on your neighbor's garden or farm. And annual means that within 1 year you can plant and save that seed. So a good place to start. You also need to consider your climate and the length of your season. Some crops for seed require a much longer season than they would for harvesting a vegetable. So take something like lettuce and as an example, you might get a head of lettuce in 45, 60 days to harvest. But in order to get seed, it can require up to, you know, over 120 days for that plant to go through the flowering process and set viable seed. So you may need to be thinking about adjusting your planting time or even trying a trial of something to see whether or not it'll make good seed in your climate before you plant an extensive area. Also, start with what you love. You will pay attention to it so much more if it's something that you have some passion for. So if, you know, if somebody told you to save bean seed because it's super easy, but you don't really like beans, pick something you love, even if it's a little bit harder. Local seeds, if you buy seeds from a local regional seed company, it's likely that they have actually grown that seed themselves, which is a good indication that it will mature in your climate, that it may be more adapted to your region. Heirlooms also are open pollinated, a good place to start. Some heirlooms have, you know, great stories and diversity to preserve in the process of seed saving. So also a rewarding place to start. And consider your scale and whether or not managing isolation from cross-pollination is feasible in your situation, what you pick to grow. Saving seed is also a connection to our own histories, our collective histories, the stories of our varieties. And I think about this as particularly relevant within the context of the Culinary Breeding Network, which is really a celebration of our cultural food pathways. We've had the honor to be collaborating in a couple of projects here in the Northwest, a national project that's preserving heirloom collards, which was started by Ira Wallace from Southern Exposure Seed Exchange, one of OSA's board members, but also a champion of collards and of varieties that preserve our past. We also have had the honor to work with a woman named Nalita, who is a Oaxacan immigrant farmer, very successful farmer, who's been stewarding our trials in tortilla corns. And we really look to Nalita for her cultural knowledge, her history of working with tortillas. And when we do the evaluation, she's the one that leads the evaluation criteria. But it's a very rewarding way to stay connected with your foods by being able to save seed. I mentioned before, starting with heirlooms, open pollinated varieties. Open pollinated varieties are varieties that will, if you save seed and it hasn't crossed with something else in your garden, you will get something that looks similar to what you planted, meaning that it's managed as a population of individual plants that have consistent traits or what it looks like is consistent from one plant to the next. So when you save seed, you will get something that looks like what you started with. If you save seed from a hybrid has been an intentional cross that was made by a breeding company to cross two different populations. So when you save seed from a hybrid, you may get more of a range of plant types that come from the next generation of seed, some of which may look like one of the populations that was initially crossed or the other. Sometimes with hybrids, you can also run into some reproductive issues occasionally. So if you really just went into save seed in order to preserve variety, look for open pollinated populations. A hybrid might be a more interesting start for a breeding project, which we can talk about tomorrow. Self-pollinated just simply means that the plant pollinates itself. So from one single flower, the male and female parts or the pollen producing and pollen receiving parts of the plant are in the same flower. And so it is much less likely to cross with other plants in the field or other varieties in your garden. Cross-pollinated plants are plants where you have multiple plants that openly share pollen and fertilize each other within a population. And so with a cross-pollinated plants, there's much more likelihood of that pollen being crossed from another variety. And you want to be maintaining that isolation in order to keep your variety true to type. Heirloom is a term that is commonly used, generally roughly referencing a variety that has been stewarded or saved for more than 50 years. But when we say varieties and they pass down from one generation to another, they don't always stay exactly the way they were 50 years ago. So you may be saving seed from something that has been passed down for 50 years, and eventually it could still be to you a cherished heirloom, but it may change subtly from year to year in its qualities and in its traits and its adaptability to your location. So at a certain point, you may not call it the same thing as you started with, but all heirlooms are open pollinated varieties as opposed to F1s. So if you're saving seed from an heirloom, you know it's something that you can likely save and get something true to type, more or less. Heirloom is also generally a term used to reference varieties that hold some cultural and historical recognition and perhaps are not being prioritized in modern large-scale agriculture. Just a little flower anatomy. We were talking about self-pollinating and cross-pollinating. This is a perfect flower, meaning that it has both the pollen-producing and the pollen-receiving portions of the plant. The pollen-producing parts, of course, are the anther, and the anthers then release that pollen, which is applied to the stigma, which is the end of the pistil. And that stigmatic surface is slightly sticky, so the pollen sticks to it and then actually germinates on the surface of that stigma and grows down the style in order to reach the ovary and achieve fertilization. So in order to make a seed, you have to have both pollination, the act of the pollen being received by the stigma, and then fertilization, that pollen growing down the style and pollinating the ovary, fertilizing the ovary in order to set seed. Perfect flowers, as I mentioned before, contain both the pollen releasing and pollen receiving parts of the flower. Examples are tomato, bean, peas, broccoli, cabbage. So both cross-pollinating and self-pollinating plants, species. Monoecious means one house in Latin, which means that there are separate, different types of floral structures on a single plant, some of which produce pollen and some of which have the stigma and the ovary and make the fruit, essentially where the seed is received, is produced. Dioecious flowers means two houses. So you have plants that have pollen producing flowers and plants that have the pollen receiving flowers, but on separate plants, not on the same plant. Examples are spinach, asparagus, hemp, and ginkgo. Annuals, as we mentioned in the beginning, is a good place to start because they complete their reproductive cycle in 1 year. So a lot of the things where we eat the fruit that has the seed, the visual seed, so like the seed of a tomato is an example of an annual, or a bean, and corn is another example. These are things where when we harvest it for food, you also actually see the seed producing portion of the plant. Biennials take 2 years. So a lot of biennials, we don't see the flowers when we grow them as a vegetable. So things like carrots and beets and cabbage, they go through the winter and acquire exposure to cold in order to trigger the plant to initiate flowering and seed set the next year. So this is an evolutionary mechanism to ensure that the plant itself stores up energy in the root or in the plant the first year, but then doesn't produce flowers and try to set seed going into the winter when you wouldn't have pollinators and you wouldn't have successful seed production. So the following spring after exposure to cold, you'll see the carrots send up a flowering stalk and seed set, or same thing with cabbage and beets. And with that, I'm gonna break. If there's any questions about this basic start, I'm happy to take them now. And I'm gonna release my screen sharing so Lori can go into the biology a little bit deeper.
So far, nobody's asking questions, but I'm getting text messages too that people are really appreciating this. There's a lot of really good information here.
All right, that's my little F1.
Yes. Okay, so if you guys want to keep going, that'd be great.
Okay,
great.
We can always talk more at the end.
Okay, so I'm just gonna dig a little bit deeper. One of the things that's really neat about seed production is on the surface, it's really easy. You let the plants do what they want to naturally do, which is reproduce and make seeds and move themselves on into the future and make more generations. And once you start sort of peeling back, there's just a lot to it. And it's a really, really intriguing and pretty magical process. So I'm gonna just go one layer deeper with all of you. And we're gonna go back to self-pollination and just talk about some of the things that really make self-pollination happen. Because if you don't know whether a crop is self-pollinated or cross-pollinated, you can look it up and there are some great resources out there, but there aren't resources for everything, particularly if you are a flower seed producer. The resources for which flowers and which varieties and species are self and or cross-pollinated are very few and far between. So in order to self-pollinate, these crops have to have perfect flowers, right? You have to have the pollen producing and the seed producing parts in the same flower. So they're always going to have perfect flowers, and they're often going to have fused petals or fused flowers. This is a fava bean plant in this photo here. And actually underneath these wing petals, there's a keel that's actually fused together. And so if you cannot see the pollen and seed bearing parts of the flower, that is a strong indication that it's probably self-pollinated because it's keeping those hidden. So in order to keep the pollen to itself and keep wind, environmental conditions or pollinators from moving that pollen around. And if you can see them, they're often very close together. I'll show you in the next slide, cross-pollination crops do the opposite. And in self-pollinating varieties and crops, sorry, it's not really variety specific, you're gonna see relatively few seeds per plant, and those seeds are gonna be pretty big. So the evolutionary strategy of self-pollination is basically that these plants have figured out the genetic package that works, and they figured out the genetic package that works really well. So they put a lot of energy into making big seeds that have a lot of energy in them, and then they just don't have as many. So for the cross-pollinated crops, these can have any of the three different types of flowers that Michaela described. So you might see perfect flowers, you might see a plant with monoecious flowers, corn is a great example of that with tassels and silks, or the dioecious flowers here in the middle, you see these two plants, this is a seed-bearing spinach plant here on the left and a pollen-bearing spinach plant on the right. You'll often see a lot of pollen if you have a wind-pollinated crop. Spinach is a wind-pollinated crop, and so you'll just see tons and tons of pollen, and the pollen grains are very small, and they disperse when the plant is either moved by wind or if you knock into it. You'll often see a lot of flowers. They often won't be super huge, but they'll be really colorful, they'll smell good, they'll have qualities that attract insects to them that make them really amenable to having visitors and having their pollen moved around. So here on the right, down the bottom, this pink and yellow, you'll see these are buckwheat, a small flower, but lots of flowers, and they're fairly showy considering how small they are. Here on the left, this is phacelia, also known as bee's friend. We use it a lot on our research farm for cover crop, and also it's a great pollinator and beneficial insect attractor. But the thing to point out here is look how long these stamens are. The anthers are actually on the end of each one of these. This is the filament here. that's just putting that pollen way, way out and way far away from the stigmatic surface. So that's a strong indicator that it wants its pollen moved around. And when you are dealing with the wind pollinated crops, that's mostly going to be in the Chenopodiaceae family. So beets, spinach, Swiss chard, although they produce lots of pollen, it's very, very hard to see their flowers. They're really inconspicuous and very small. So this is just a close-up of those traits and qualities we were just talking about. Here on the bottom left, you've got a sweet pea. That's a close-up of that fused keel. You can get some crossing. There are insects and bees that will drill holes in there and get in there. And you may be tricked by this because these flowers, they're big, they're showy, they smell really good. But self-pollinating crops can also benefit from the visiting of insects and beneficials that come and land on it and actually physically shake the flower that helps dehisce that pollen and move it around inside the flower structure. So even though it's not using those insects to move pollen from one flower to another, it is using insect attractants to help it pollinate. These are tomato flowers, and this is an example of how within a crop you can see variation in how much cross-pollination you're going to get. So here on the left, this is the anther cone, and one thing to notice is this anther cone is actually fused together, and the pistil and the stigmatic surface are inside of this anther cone, making it very difficult to get any cross-pollination. This flower on the right still has that fused anther cone, but it has an exerted stigma. So it's pushing that stigmatic surface out beyond the anther cone, making it more accessible and much more likely to cross-pollinate. And you tend to see this more in the heirloom tomatoes and the smaller market classes. Often you'll see this trait a little bit more in like cherry tomatoes than you will in slicing tomatoes. So self and cross-pollinating, like most things in nature, is not a black or white phenomenon. It exists on a spectrum. And you have crops that are very strongly self-pollinated. These are going to be your peas, your beans, your lettuce. You'll see very little outcrossing. And if you're trying to do breeding, it can be difficult to actually get these to cross. There are certainly ways to do it. And then on the other end, you've got cross-pollinated crops. Really strongly cross-pollinated crops are brassicas. The brassicas will even have biological mechanisms that will, where they recognize their own pollen and they won't accept it. So they really want pollen from another plant. And then you've got all these things in the middle, peppers and squash, umbels even. Squash is a great example. Those flowers can both self-pollinate and cross-pollinate. So now we're gonna go even one layer deeper and talk about population size. So when you're dealing with self-pollinating crops, you can have a small population, maybe five plants in your garden or on your farm and save seed and still get really quality, robust, healthy seed because those plants don't need each other in order to create genetic diversity and genetic resiliency. So you can save seed from a smaller number of plants, and that's what we call the population size. With the really strongly cross-pollinated things, you want to save seed from a lot of plants, ideally 50, 100 different plants, because they want that genetic mixing. They want to share their genes with each other, and that's how they maintain genetic resiliency and genetic diversity, and that's really important to their health. So if you save seed from smaller numbers, smaller populations of strongly cross-pollinated crops, like say five broccoli plants, you will likely get plants that are just fine the next generation. But if you keep doing that over time, you'll start to see a decline in vigor and a decline in how robust the plants are. So, and then of course in the middle, you're talking probably more like 10 plants, 20 plants, depending on what crop you're working with. And then in another aspect to maintaining that genetic health and integrity and robustness, you need to think about isolation. And isolation means keeping it separate from other varieties or other compatible species that might be growing in your garden, on your farm, on the roadside, in your neighbor's garden or farm. So when you're working with your self-pollinated crops, that's not so much of an issue because it's much more difficult for them to cross. So you can grow them, you know, in the next bed over, or you can grow them 5 feet apart if you're growing things that are really strongly self-pollinated. When you're growing things that are really strongly cross-pollinated, you're going to need a lot more distance. And that's because wind carries pollen really far. Bees carry pollen really far. And so you need to think about, do you have compatible species? If you're growing winter squash and summer squash are the same species. So if you're growing delicata and zucchini, for instance, those can actually cross-pollinate, even though they're very different crops, they're the same species. If you're growing carrots for seed, carrots are compatible with Queen Anne's lace, which is a weed that's very common. And if you've got Queen Anne's lace and you're growing near a roadside, or you're growing near a meadow where you've got a bunch of those flowers, you need to think about that. If you have buildings and trees and physical barriers in the way that can help mitigate that and give you a little more flexibility there. And then I'm going to wrap up here with some pollination requirements. So when you're thinking about growing seed, as Michaela mentioned, it can be really different than growing vegetables. And you want to think plants are in a different reproductive stage when they go into their flowering and pollination. And they can withstand different temperatures, or they need different temperatures during that time. Cool season crops, if they're in a hot area, their pollen can dry out. And it can die, it can become desiccated. Think about that isolation and what you've got growing and what's growing around you. If you are growing in a greenhouse, or you're growing in some sort of shade structure or caterpillar tunnel, and you've got something that's cross-pollinated, think about pollinators. You may need to add some pollinators. You can buy them online, get them shipped to you. What's your prevailing wind direction? If you're growing corn, dry corn or sweet corn, it's another wind pollinated crop, you're gonna need wind to move it around. And you wanna think about which directions that's gonna move through your field or your patch. And then rain or irrigation. This is especially important during pollination time because you can wet down pollen and you can drown it, or you can wash it off the plants. And so if you've got natural rain during a pollination, important pollination time, or you need to irrigate, you want to minimize or not use overhead irrigation. So we've mostly talked through these, but just a sort of summary wrap up for this section, you want to grow different species. If you're going to grow something of the same class, you know, you can grow multiple types of squash, you can grow multiple types of flowers, you can grow multiple types of kales, make friends with your neighbors, consider what you might want to let cross. We grow zinnias at our research farm as markers in our field and as for beauty and pollinator attractants. And we started out with several different varieties and just let them all cross. And now we have this beautiful, colorful population that we get to work with. So cross-pollination is not always bad. Sometimes it can be really fun, and sometimes it can lead you down the path of a breeding project. This is the last slide. Can you eat it? Yes, you can still eat crops while you are simultaneously producing seed on them. You want to eat from the less desirable plants, the plants that are maybe not quite as healthy, not quite as robust, not quite as productive, because those are the ones that are also producing your best seed. And with some crops, you can eat them and also make selections and grow seed on them. So come back and join us tomorrow at the same time, and we'll talk a little bit more about this and how you do selections for culinary quality. But for most of our crops, we can eat at least part of them, or we can eat the ones that aren't aren't doing quite as well, because those are the ones that are going to give you the best seed. And with that, I will stop sharing my screen and hand it over to Jared and answer any questions that you might have.
That was great, Lori. No questions, to people saying that they really enjoy it and it's very comprehensive. And all the questions I wrote down, you already answered. But I do have a question about, you showed the tomato. Yes, good job. The two different tomato flowers and the one that has a stigma that's sticking out. Like, what does that mean, like, as far as evolution? Like, which one happened first? Why is it that the cherry ones are like that? And then also, like, are the, like, hybrids bred to be more fused? Like, what's going on with that?
I could take that.
Well, I will answer that a little bit. I was going to say, I'll let Jared do that, because he's actually the tomato breeder on our team. So, Jared, go ahead.
Okay. So, in general, when you see when you see species that have both inbreeding and outcrossing happening in the same species, or even when you see kind of closely related species where you have inbreeders and outcrossers, in general, the outcrossing species are the ancestral types. And part of that is because that outcrossing leads to this diversity and adaptability that allows it to sort of withstand changing environments and find, you know, new niches. In general, in evolutionary time, the inbreeding, what happens is inbreeding will happen as a mutation out of an outcrossing species. And that inbreeding in turn will kind of, because it locks in the genes, lets it really hone in and be very well adapted to its specific niche that it does well in, and, you know, keep that adaptation for that niche. But then if those niches disappear, then a lot of times those inbreeders die out, and, you know, you get new inbreeders that then come out of the kind of ancestral outcrossing population. With tomatoes, the outcrossing is more ancestral. The inbreeding is more recent. And then part of that is, you know, as people have become, you know, have domesticated crops, we become more responsible for making sure that these seeds propagate and the plants propagate. And so some of the mechanisms that allow crops to be able to adapt to the environment on their own are no longer as necessary, including outcrossing. So, you know, as crops get domesticated, sometimes, you know, inbreeding can happen because it doesn't need to be so adaptable.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you.
Any other questions?
There's not right now. I think you guys are doing a really great job of explaining everything.
So I am going to pick up where Lori and Michaela left off, and I'm going to talk about some growing practices. So we talked about, in general, kind of the principles of what to think about when you're saving seed and the different types of seed. And so I just want to really briefly walk you through the season of growing seed crops. And of course, every seed crop is unique. Every species and every location requires different planning. And as you go on in your seed saving endeavors, you're going to learn more and more about your specific environment, about your seeds, and about tailoring some of these practices to best fit you. But just to give you a brief overview, I'm going to start with general growing practices. So compared to growing just vegetables, for example, for eating, what are some differences when you're growing them for seed? First off is in terms of timing. In general, seed crops take much longer to mature. So I'm going to kind of pick on this lettuce because we have this slide of lettuce here. And if you think about it, to grow lettuce to eat, it's a fairly rapid crop between, you know, from going from seed to a harvestable crop. To be able to grow lettuce for seed, this now has to not just grow, you know, vegetative leaves, but it's going to make flower stalks, it's going to have flower, it's going to self-pollinate, and then those seeds are going to mature in time for harvest. So we're talking, you know, adding months of time onto what your normal schedule was for this, you know, lettuce if you were just growing it to eat. More or less similar parallels for a lot of the other, especially dry-seeded crops that you eat vegetatively. For fruiting crops like tomatoes, for example, you know, they're more or less going to be similar timing. You know, you're going to be harvesting tomatoes for seed just slightly later than you would for eating. Same thing for winter squash. You know, you're actually growing a mature fruit. And so that fruit and those seeds inside are going to be mature and good for seed saving. So it varies, but the general rule is that you expect to have a longer season when you're growing something for seed than when you're growing it to eat. Spacing is also different in that a lot of these crops are going to be much larger as they grow into their full, you know, reproductive selves. So looking again at these lettuce plants, you know, imagine them when they were just growing for, you know, just as a head of lettuce, they're going to be much smaller and they're going to start to spread out quite a bit. So you want to kind of plan ahead for that and make sure that you'll be able to allow your plants to get up to the full size that they're going to need to get to be able to make seed. Some of what you can do, for example, at a garden scale is you may grow them at the denser spacing that you might be growing to eat them, but then go ahead and, as long as you have enough of them, start to thin out some of the plants, and we'll talk about this more in breeding, you know, but thin out the plants that might not be looking as good and eat those ones, and then make space so that the remaining plants can go all the way to growing their full size for seed. Differences in terms of staking. Some plants may require staking, like again, kind of looking at these lettuce or some other plants that are going to make large flower stalks, depending on kind of your, you know, wind conditions and things like that. You may have to stake plants. Irrigation difference here is that in general, it's a good rule for any dry seeded crop. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more later, but any dry seeded crop, once they're starting to flower, you do not want to be letting water get on those flowers and or on the developing seeds. And so if you were overhead irrigating, you know, with sprinklers before, once they're starting to switch over into forming flower stalks and flowering, you want to make sure that the irrigation is happening at the soil surface. So either with drip or, you know, some way that you're watering at the base and not allowing water to come on top. That helps reduce any premature sprouting. It helps reduce diseases. Fertility really more or less is very similar to what you would have with your, you know, if you're just growing this for food. You know, keep in mind, again, these are going to be long season crops that are going to need, you know, to have, you know, fertility and water, you know, through the course of their, you know, their full life cycle. Weed management, this really comes down to similar, actually, disease management comes down to the fact that these are going to be such long season crops. They are going to get pretty big. And so you want to keep up on your weeding throughout the season. You know, again, something, you know, looking at this lettuce crop, you know, something where it's like, well, if there's a few weeds in here, I'm going to just come along and harvest all these to eat soon enough and, you know, till this under, and I don't need to worry as much. When it comes to something with a long season, like lettuce seed, you want to go ahead and keep weeding this crop, you know, as long as you can, because what you don't want to have is those weeds getting just as big as your lettuce, getting all tangled up in there. And then when it comes time to harvest, you've got, you know, a big mess that you'll have to deal with. So here's where things get a little different. Once it comes time to harvest, now you've got a whole different process than you really would have with crops that you're eating. And so this is the process I'm going to go over the next, you know, 10 minutes or so, talking about the harvest process itself, threshing, cleaning, drying, and storage. So when we're talking about harvest, what we're really talking about is how do we get these plants out of the field? This can happen in a lot of different ways, depending on the scale that you're growing, depending on the crop that you're working with. It can happen, you know, cutting the plants, you know, at the base, pulling the plants, which I generally don't recommend because you'd like to keep the soil in the ground and not mixed in with your harvested crop. You might be bending these plants over and banging them into a bucket so that their seeds shatter out of the pods or off of the plants and fall directly into a bucket. It could be hand collecting, you know, in the case of something like tomatoes or other fruits where you're just picking individual fruits. You know, there's lots of different tools that you might be using for this. You know, and then kind of at larger commercial scales, you may be using, you know, a combine or, you know, something like that. once you've got the plant harvested, meaning, you know, just out of the field in some way, often you're going to go through a second step of drying this harvested material down. So you've still got seed and a lot of plant material connected together. And, you know, a lot of it, it might still be pretty wet. So in order to go through the next step of threshing, what you want to do is get this seed dry. This also allows a little bit more seed maturation to happen. A little bit, the seed can get a little bit, you know, fuller and fully vigorous by letting it just absorb a little bit more material from those plants as they're drying down. So, you know, some tips here. If your weather is nice, you know, you can be drying these outside. If you're going to dry them on a material, you want that to be a breathable material. Here, this is like a floating row cover or a material like underlayment for paving. This is a synthetic but breathable material. If you're putting this on tarps, you have to be really careful because that impermeable layer of the tarp, moisture can form at that interface between the plants and the tarp, and that moisture and condensation can start to cause rot. So in general, avoid tarps, but either which way, it's actually good to be flipping these occasionally so that the wetter bottom surface gets exposed to the sun and the wind. If your conditions are not great for doing this outside, you can bring this inside to, you know, if you've got a high tunnel, if you've got, you know, some kind of space that is protected from rain. But when you bring it inside, just make sure that you've got lots of air movement. That's key. You know, whether you're doing that with fans, you know, you might want to set those on top of, you know, screens, something so that the air can be getting underneath the plants and that lots of air is moving through it. And that the, you know, it says heat is useful. It's certainly better to be warm than cold, but the air is really the key here. You know, lots of dry air. So once you've got your plants relatively dry so that they're, you know, kind of crispy, now you can go through threshing. Threshing is basically just the process of somehow breaking the seeds free from the non-seed material. So in this case, you could do this in lots of different ways, from driving over it with a truck. In the case, you know, usually be careful with larger seeded crops like, you know, large beans, things like that. They can get damaged by, you know, this amount of pressure, but smaller seeded crops like brassicas, you know, they often can handle that, especially if you've got a thick material. It's being driven on grass, not on concrete. It could be just you stomping on it in a bucket, as Michaela's demonstrating here, or your friends, you know, doing this. You know, you could put these into a pillowcase, you know, and beat them. You can, there's also lots of small and medium, large scale equipment that basically all does the same thing, which is just trying to mash the plants, the nice and dry plant material so that the seeds get separated from the plants. You could be rubbing this through hardware cloth or screens with the idea that you're not necessarily cleaning this. You still have seed and non-seed material, but the seeds are broken up so that they're no longer attached to the stalks. At that point, now we get to cleaning. I'm going to start with kind of cleaning divides into two different directions, depending on if we talk about dry seeds, which are seeds that when they're when the fruits are fully mature, the fruits are dry. So this would be things like brassicas, you know, cabbages, things like that, where, you know, we have a dry seed pod. Lettuce, that's actually a naked seed that's dry on the plant. Beans, again, you know, in a dry pod. Those are all dry seeds where you're dealing with dry material versus wet seeds where they're, that when the fruits are mature, they are, you know, a wet fruit. So this would be something like tomatoes, cucumbers, melons, all those things in that family, winter squash. Those are all wet seeds and they're going to have a slightly different process. So starting with dry seeds, there's kind of two fundamental processes for how you separate the seeds from the chaff, the non-seed material. The first is screening. And this basically takes advantage of the fact that seeds tend to be all more or less the same size as each other. And so there's two ways that you basically can get a screen, where one is where you have a screen where the mesh size of the screen is such that the seeds can fall through the screen, but The non-seed material, the larger stems, sticks, leaves, etc., stay up on top of that screen. And then the second way that you can do it is you get a screen where the screen size, the mesh of the screen is such that the seeds stay on top and the dust and really small chaff, the small non-seed material, falls through the screen. And so by doing that, you can separate out a lot of the chaff from the seeds. The other technique here is winnowing. And this takes advantage of the fact that seeds tend to be dense and denser than the leaves, the stems, the non-seed material that you're trying to clean out of it. And so if you apply wind, if you're dropping seeds down and wind is blowing, the seeds will tend to drop straighter down and the non-seed material will tend to get blown by the wind. So we can see a few examples here. Just using natural wind, they're pouring slowly out of these nice flat bottom containers, kind of pouring a slow, even stream of seed and chaff out of these smaller containers into these larger totes. And the wind's blowing, and it's blowing the chaff away, and the seeds are falling to the bucket. You can see here, he's using two box fans, set up, next to each other and having them turn on. And you can see here, the chaff is being blown all the way past those totes, and the seed is going to be falling, a stream of seeds is going to be falling. He's aiming, actually. He's looking closely and trying to aim, so the bulk of the seeds here that he can see are coming right at the edge of this first container. He's got a second container here to catch lighter seeds, and just in case a mistake happens, he can always re-winnow those seeds and not lose them. And then this third example here is actually kind of a reverse fan setup where the fan is sucking instead of blowing. And that works slightly better if you can set up a box like this that just fits your fan and has kind of these wings extending out. That's actually sucking in, makes a slightly less turbulent airflow and gets better control of the air and allows you to be more precise in how close you can get to the edge with your seeds and lets you clean it faster. So moving on to wet seed extraction, first step, kind of just like the threshing of the dry seed, somehow you've got to separate those seeds from the fruit, whether it's scooping, smashing, spinning here. Then for some wet seeded crops, this fermentation step happens. And so for cucumbers and tomatoes, if you imagine those seeds, they kind of have this slimy gel, this mucilaginous coating around those seeds. And this fermentation step helps dissolve that gel. For other crops like squash, the fermentation step will just help sort of dissolve some of the stringy placental material that's attached to the seeds, make it more soupy and easier to clean later, but it's not strictly necessary. This process happens, it will take either, somewhere between a day, 2 to 3 days. A lot of this will depend on your temperatures that you're experiencing. You'd like to have it in warm temperatures. Basically, what you're going to be doing is putting your seeds, often just with the pulp that it comes with, like in the case of tomatoes. Sometimes you may add a small amount of water, but you want this to be a fairly sugary, thick mix that is fermenting. You allow it to ferment for a day or two to three, stirring twice a day, looking in the case of cucumbers and tomatoes, has that gel dissolved? At that point, once it's dissolved, you go to the rinsing and decanting process. So this process, basically, take that container that you started with, add clean water till you fill it up to the top, and then slowly pour off that container, and what pours off the top of it is the pulp, the light seeds, and you keep pouring, keep pouring, keep pouring until when you get close to the bottom of the bucket, you're going to start to see the seeds, the nice heavy seeds that have settled to the bottom. At that point, stop pouring, add more water, give it a quick swirl, let it settle again, and then can pour off again, pouring, 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 until just before you start to pour off good seeds. Repeat this process several times until all you have is clear water and seeds. At that point, go ahead and pour off those seeds and then spread them out in a nice thin layer and get them drying quickly, because these seeds, once they are done fermenting, they're liable to sprout on you or get diseased if you leave them in a big clump and wet. So get them dry quickly. So now you've got your seeds harvested, you've got them clean. How do you keep these seeds around so that you can plant them next year and maybe the year after that and the year after that? A few keys to seed storage include having a cool, dry, and dark location. Kind of the general rule that you hear is if you take the temperature in Fahrenheit and you add it to your relative humidity, you'd like those two numbers to be less than 100. So for example, if you have 50 degrees Fahrenheit, 50% relative humidity, that's a good amount. You'd like it to be dry. You'd also like it to be consistent temperatures, consistent humidity throughout the, you know, so in a place that's not like getting sun part of the day, you know, think about, you know, kind of, you know, nice little, you know, kind of pantry places where it's nice and cool. You'd like to make sure that it's clearly labeled and protected from pests. And, you know, one trick I would say is when you're storing seeds, if you put a, like a lick to seal envelope in down through the middle of your seeds, you can take that envelope out occasionally and check. Is the envelope still feel crispy, like nice and crinkly dry paper, or does it start to feel less crinkly, or did the lick to seal surface stick to itself? If it stuck to itself, that's a sign that humidity is too high inside that container. You want to take it out and re-dry those seeds before you put it back in there. So I know that was a lot that came at you really quickly, and fortunately, there's a lot of resources for you to learn more if this is something that you're interested and excited about learning more from. One place that I would recommend, in my biased opinion, is check out seedalliance.org. We have a plethora of free publications from basic seed saving to crop-specific seed saving, lots of guides, handouts to check out and download for free. We have many of our resources are now available in Spanish as well. And if you're interested in a more season-long learning experience, we have an organic seed internship. So if you're involved as a farm worker working on farms and you want to take a course that complements your learning experience, you can take this internship. And this is a season-long course that walks you through what will be happening sort of each month of the year as seed growing progresses. We also have a self-directed course available at this website here. If this website address is too long, just go to seedalliance.org and you'll see an announcement of our seed course, and check that out because you'll have a lot of great resources there. Final advice, some of these just follow what Michaela said at the beginning, you know, starting small, starting with a crop you love, starting with annuals, making sure it's something that can mature seed in your climate, making sure it's something that works in your system in terms of, you know, being able to integrate with the other crops that you're growing and what you have time for. You know, a lot, there's often a really big time pressure there during harvest and drying, you know, harvest and threshing time. So make sure that that fits with your system. Think ahead, make sure that you have a space. If, you know, you live in a place like I do in the, you know, in the north and north, or the, you know, northwest, where it gets rainy in the fall all of a sudden, you know, make sure you can be bringing those seeds somewhere to have them complete their drying and that space is available to you. And really, there's so much to learn here. So this is, lean on other seed growers and, you know, meet the, you know, find opportunities to meet them and share their information with them. One of the places you can do that is, you know, through some of our social media channels here. You know, you can stay in touch with us by subscribing for our newsletter, find out when events are happening, and check us out, you know, on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. All those are places to kind of learn about what's happening in the seed growing world and learn from each other. So at that point, yeah, we're all open for questions if people have them.
Great. Jared, I just wanted to chime in and mention that the online course will be taught bilingual in Spanish this year, and we will be working on some mentorship options if there are any Spanish-speaking students who are not able to participate in an on-farm internship. They can email me for more information.
Guys, this was great. I think you've done this before. because you answered all the questions. There's one that just came in though, of asking about if seeds can possibly get too dry, like if they're in a place that maybe that could be a possible problem. Should they put a silica packet in it? What is there any issues with that?
Who wants to take that one? The quick answer is yes. Seeds can be too dry as well as too wet. You, as Jared mentioned, the envelope test or with a little coin envelope is a good one just to give you a real quick read. You can also buy a hygrometer. They're pretty cheap. You can go on and find them online and that will give you a reading of the temperature and the relative humidity. But you can get seeds too dry and you can desiccate them and kill them. They are alive. Or you can get them so dry that you'll get a really hard seed coat. And that happens in the bigger seeds rather than the smaller seeds. That's also a naturally hard seed is what it's referred to. It's also a naturally occurring phenomenon. You see it more in some crops than others. You see it fairly often in sweet peas. But that can make water penetration more difficult when you go to plant the seeds. And you may need to do some sort of scarification or soaking if you see that.
Okay. I would go ahead.
No, I just wanted to add that while you can overdry them, I think that is much less common to overdry than underdry. And a key is that once you start drying your seed, you want to keep that fan or heat or whatever you're using to get it dried down. Keep that applied until it's entirely dry, because a bigger issue is if you start drying it, then what's happening is that moisture is evaporating from the outside of the seed and that moisture is still trapped in the center of the seed. So then if you stop that drying process, you can get cracking from that uneven drying, drying front.
Yeah. I would second what Michaela said. In general, at least in my experience, you know, worry more about getting your seeds dry enough rather than worry about over drying. It's pretty hard to overdry, and it's definitely easy to not dry them enough and have seeds that.
At least in our climate.
Yes, right. It's true. Right, exactly. If you're watching this from New Mexico, you've got less to worry about that way.
Can I just add another quick note? If you're trying to do any like really long-term seed storage or archiving, where you're thinking about putting seeds in a freezer. Or a deep freeze, which can also be used for pest control. It's one way to deal fairly effectively with weevils, pea weevils. But in that case, like, you do actually need to make sure that your seed is quite dry, or you can, you know, the water crystals that are still in the seed can burst the cell walls. And then another note, when you take that seed out, if you do any storage in a refrigerator or a freezer, when you take it out, you want to let the container come up to room temperature before you open it. Because if you open it and it's cold and dry, then you're in, all of a sudden it's in this, you know, your room is 65, 70 degrees and probably 50 to 60% relative humidity. And all of a sudden that's just going to get sucked right into that seed container. And you can really damage seed that way.
Great. Lori, those are the two questions I was going to ask. You guys are awesome at this. I just want to let you know that Michaela, you put your email address in here about the seed course. I typed it into YouTube because they can't see this stuff. They can only see what's on YouTube. So I put it in there. Just so that you guys know about that tomorrow too. Tomorrow, Jay Bost, who you guys know, and you've done one of these courses with in Oahu, he's going to be the facilitator and he'll type things in here. If there's anything you want people to know, we'll type it in there, but we can also say it, because when it's recorded and people watch it later, they don't see the chat with it. Only the people are watching, and a lot more people come back afterwards. So if you guys are interested in that seed course, please contact OSA. Michaela's email is michaela@seedalliance.org. Really fantastic course. And you guys didn't mention this, but I thought maybe I would, is that also your seed garden book. This was written by by Michaela and Jared and edited by Seed Savers Exchange. And so it's a really fantastic resource also, I think. So if you guys want to you know, invest in buying something, that's a fantastic book as well. Yeah. Well, this has been really great. I think it's very thorough. Klaus wanted to say thank you. He said he's going to send it to a lot of people to watch. He felt like it was very well organized and executed. Tomorrow we get to dive deeper into plant breeding, same time, same place. And Jay Boss will be facilitating that. And I mean, this has been great. It's really a fantastic like resource to have all of this here in one spot for people to be able to point to coming back here and watching it, because I think that some people have been on here for quite some time watching, and it is probably just a lot to digest in one day. So we definitely heard, I didn't even ask the question in the questionnaire of like, you know, I just said, what do you want to get out of this? And I had like 1,000 people register. And I mean, probably 300 people said, how do we save our own seed and how do we do our own plant breeding? Like they typed it in themselves. So there's a lot of interest in it. So this will be really helpful for people.
Thanks. We're looking forward to watching some and of the crop specific sessions too.
Great. Yeah, we had some great ones today. And you guys are up in 2 days, I think. I'm not sure which day, but
Wednesday at 7 o'clock will be everything carrots.
Yes.
And tomorrow at noon, same place, same time for plant breeding 101, beginning plant breeding.
Great. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Lynn.